Thank you. Good morning, everybody, and welcome to the Santa Cruz County Regional Transportation Commission meeting this Thursday, February 4th.
You're cutting out.
It's February 4th and 9 o'clock, and it's the RTC meeting. I welcome everybody. Can we have roll call?
Commissioner Bertrand?
Here.
Commissioner Brown?
Here.
Commissioner Johnson?
Here.
Commissioner Montesino?
Here.
Commissioner Caput?
Here.
Commission Alternate Shiffrin?
Here.
Commission Alternate Mulhern?
Here.
Commissioner Koenig?
Here.
Commissioner McPherson? Commissioner McPherson? Okay, maybe he stepped away. I know he's here. Commissioner Alternate Myers?
Present.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Present.
Commissioner Rotkin? And Mr. Tim Gubbins?
Present.
Rotkin here. Sorry, I was muted.
Okay.
Well, welcome, welcome commissioners, and welcome the public that's out there. We're going to start with oral communications, but I'd like to start out first as the chair, and just to make a little announcement. You know, in our last public hearing for the item 19, there were some students that would wanted to speak, and due to their schedule, they weren't they had to leave, so they didn't have the opportunity to speak. And again, due to their schedule, they're not able to attend this meeting, streaming in. And so the Parker Valley High students really want to be recognized. And I think we need to recognize them. But I also want to make sure and a recommendation to our commission that in the future, that if any student within the county from the high school level on down would like to speak to us, I think we need to accommodate them and allow them to schedule their time and for any item on the agenda to be heard. And so with that, I'll leave you guys and I'll bring it back to the commission. And I thank you. Oral communication, we'll start with the public.
Let's see, we do have some hands raised. Mr. Kerry Pico?
Yes, can everybody hear me?
Yes, we hear you.
Okay, so Yesenia hopefully has put up the PowerPoint.
Not yet, give me 1 second here. Okay.
I'd like to tell you that I take my time looking at the information that people tend to not pay attention to. So here, now that we have that, I'll get started. This is about traffic, origin, destination, and the focus is on Watsonville, but it covers more. Next slide, please. Just click.
1 second, I'm sorry, I'm having a little bit of issues here.
Okay, technical difficulties. For those of you old enough to remember Outer Limits, we are in control of your screen. Anybody old enough to remember Outer Limits?
Yes.
Can you see my screen, commissioners?
We see the screen, but you're still on your first slide.
Okay, sorry about that. We're gonna have to do this again.
Is there any way that the speed,
actually, it's all about the slide, and it's really about
Can we stop you then, and we come back to you once we get that going?
No, it's there.
No, it's working.
Good enough.
We got it. All right, here you go.
Okay, just go to the top one.
This is.
Wow, this is not working today.
Just do the click on it. We don't need a slideshow. Just click on the top slide, and that will change it. There we go. So we're talking about origin destination. Go to the next slide, just click on it. I want you to know that 50% of all highway traffic that goes past Buena Vista Drive in Watsonville does not come from Watsonville, but it comes from Monterey. I shouldn't say that. 50% comes from Monterey County. Okay, and this comes from looking at these are the Highway 1 numbers that go past Buena Vista. There's 34,000. And the sources of the traffic are 22,000 come from Highway 1 North across the county line, And I was surprised to learn this, that there's 17,000 cars going north across the Papa Road Bridge. That means 34,000 across the bridge every day, at least on average. And then when you account for the on-ramp, off-ramps, and all that stuff that I go through in paying attention to detail, you come to about 17,000 cars come from Monterey County. So when we talk about the need for transit for Watsonville and all the traffic on Highway 1, you're missing the big banana. It's really about the traffic coming from out of county. Next slide. But let's talk about Watsonville. Where are Watsonville commuters going? This is from the census. And the census does a three-year survey, a one-year survey, and so this doesn't capture all the workers or anything, but this is what they had. That 30, if you look at where Watsonville people are heading north, by the way, most of them are heading south for work. And by the way, you'd be surprised that more people, both in Santa Cruz and Watsonville, work outside of their city of residence, yeah, as opposed to that. So anyway, 30% head to Santa Cruz that are, you know, that are heading north. And I was surprised to see the 70% head to the Bay Area or Scotts Valley kind of stuff. So when you talk about we need to have transit that takes people from Watsonville to Santa Cruz for their work, you're missing the understanding of the picture. You're not addressing it. You're missing two-thirds of the population. Thank you, Mr. Pico. Yes?
Thank you for your time.
I just got started.
I'm aware of that, but you've
exceeded. Don't I get 3 minutes?
2 minutes.
Do I not get three minutes?
No, sir. I'm allowing 2 minutes for oral communications.
Well,
thank you.
Are you really going to pull this off that you had me on hold and then you cut it off?
But this is one of the problems of having slides on oral
communications. I got one more slide and we're done.
Thank you, sir. Next.
Mr. David Date.
Just a reminder, this is items that are not on the agenda, and there's a 2 minute oral communication from the public.
Mr. Chair, you might suggest to the last person and others that they can always email us with their slides and comments, and we'd be happy to receive them.
Hello?
Yes,
David, you're recognized.
I'm sorry. That was exceptionally rude because Carrie was waiting patiently for you to get these slides figured out, and then obviously you're counting the clock down as he can't even get his information to show up, but I'll try to keep that within 2 minutes. This was a letter to the editor I wrote to Santa Cruz Sentinel. I just wanted to read that because I don't have the luxury of taking today off and monitoring today's proceedings. We are currently witnessing the biggest revolution in transportation since the advent of the internal combustion engine. Very few foresaw 5 years ago the possibilities that are available to today. Community bikes, electric scooters, Lyft, pedal cars, to name a few. But this is only the cusp of what's ahead. Autonomous vehicles, companies like Zoox and Tesla are seeking regulatory approval this year. Santa Cruz's own aerospace company, Joby, acquired Uber's flying car division and is looking to institute autonomous air taxi service by 2023. Nearly a dozen companies are engaged in developing Hyperloop technologies, which may replace air travel as we know it. Things are accelerating so fast that no one can definitively state what the future of transportation might look like in 5, let alone 30 years. Yet the Santa Cruz Regional Transportation Commission is engaged in a process which seeks to do exactly that. Staff's current recommendation is to promise to leave a bed of dilapidated rails as a placeholder and the off chance that the future generation happens to find their ideas about fixed line rail transit of value. This promise comes at the expense of creating a full width, multimodal pedestrian and e-bike highway, which would enable Santa Cruz to fully harness this green wave in transportation. It is refreshing to now have RTC commissioners who are delegates of the community's desire to have a safe, active transportation alternative now.
Thank you, Mr. Bates, for your time.
Community is waking up to the realities of this rail plan, and it's very dangerous for all of you.
Thank you, Mr. Bates.
Mr. Chair, would you please rule people who are speaking on other items on the agenda out of order when they begin, when it's clear that that's where they're going? Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you, Mr. Yeah, just a reminder again, please speak only on items that are not on the agenda. Also, as far as the first speaker, I did not start his time until his presentation started, just so everybody's clear on that.
Next is LD Freitas, and then we'll go to Barry Scott. Does LD Freitas rail supporter?
Mr. Freitas, you're recognized by the chair.
Sounds like he's going to talk on item 19 to me. Rail supporter, I mean.
Yeah, can't speak on the item 19. But is he there? Is he?
We can come back to him if he's having issues. How about Mr. Barry Scott and Mr. Silvergate?
We're going to move on. We'll come back to Mr. Freitas. Mr. Barry Scott, you're recognized by the chair. You have 2 minutes.
There we go. I'm calling just to thank the RTC for all their work, years and years and years of work on public transit generally. And something I don't think most of you might realize is that today is Rosa Parks' birthday. and it's been named Transit Equity Day. And I'd like to read a short 2 sentences from organizations that I belong to. It begins, "Why fight for public transit? Because access to safe, affordable, reliable public transit is access to economic opportunity. Decades of transportation policies seeped in systemic racism have exposed communities of color to more pollution and deprived them of quality mobility options. Fighting for a better public transit system is central to fighting for climate and racial justice. People deserve to move freely, which is why public transit is a civil right. This is a very special day, and I thank you for all you do."
Lee Silvergate.
Thank you for your comments. Mr. Lee Silvergate, you're recognized by the chair.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes.
Hi, everyone. Thanks for recognizing me. My name is Lee Silverglate. I'm a Santa Cruz native of the West Side who recently moved back after graduating from college. And today I'm voicing support for the passenger rail along the corridor.
Excuse me, sir. That's on item of the agenda 19.
Okay.
Do you have anything else that you'd like to speak upon that's not on the agenda?
No, it's general comment later.
Yeah, on item 19.
Okay. My mistake. Sorry about that.
No problem. You're welcome.
Deb Molina.
Is Mr. Molina or Mrs. Molina?
Ms. Molina, Deb Molina.
Yes, I also wanted to talk about trail and train.
That's on item 19, ma'am.
Okay, thank you.
No problem. We're an oral, just a reminder, we're an oral communication. It's the time for the public to be able to comment on anything that is not on the agenda for the RTC. You have 2 minutes. Is there anyone that would like to speak on an item that is not on the agenda?
I don't see any other hands raised. Oh, there's one. Charlie Wilcox.
Go ahead, Charlie Wilcox. You recognize, the chair recognizes you.
You're on mute, Mr. Wilcox.
Can't hear me. Apologize for not unmuting. Sorry about that.
No problem, sir. Your time's now.
Yep, no worries. Good morning. Thank you. I appreciate the attention. I just want to say that I feel like the ideas around the different forms of communication that are coming in the next few years are really important to take into account regarding the entire mission of the RTC. Regardless of various specific agenda items today. And I've often thought that there should be allowance in the Measure D funding to take into account what we could do to subsidize transportation for folks who are really challenged with this environment. I feel like there's enough money there that we could actually buy an e-bike for every single resident of Santa Cruz County. If we had appropriate pathways for that, it could go a long way towards solving a lot of the problems that we're dealing with. So appreciate your time and attention.
Thank you, sir.
I do not see any other hands raised, Commissioner.
Okay. Seeing none, we're going to go ahead and move on. Item three, which is additions and deletions to consent agenda and regular agenda items. We have a handout from the executive director on item 16. And we also have a replacement page for item 19. That's page 19-9. There's a strikeouts on that. I hope all the commissioners received that.
There's also a replacement page for the agenda itself, Chair Gonzalez. It just removed the word draft at the top. And there's also some additional handouts for item 19.
Okay, thank you for that. Okay, we're going to go ahead and move on to the consent agenda. The minutes, approved draft minutes for January 14th, 2021, and and accept the draft minutes for January 20, 2021.
Aurelio, we're not going to take a single action on the entire consent unless people pull things off, right?
Yeah. And then there's project planning and items. Budget and expenditure items, administrative items, and informative items. Is there anything they'd like to be pulled from the consent agenda?
Move approval of the consent agenda. This is Rodkin.
Second.
We have to ask the public.
We can back up here, yeah. Thank you, Mandy. Is there anybody from the public that would like to make a comment on any item that's on the consent agenda?
Mr. Brian Peoples.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Does that include item 10? Should I make a comment on that?
Yes.
Okay. Item 10, you know, it's great news that this truly, the recognition that rail banking is a process eliminates the single concern with using the Coastal Corridor today for a transit-oriented trail. This is exciting news that the RTC has confirmed the ownership rights of the corridor will be sustained even with the removal of the tracks. We see this as a key legal measure that will allow our community to build a trail now and preserve the corridor for future transit. This is great news. How our issue is not so much about transit in the future, but it's using the corridor today. It's already been a decade that that corridor has sat unused. And we've spent millions of dollars maintaining it. And it's poor public policy to allow this vital transportation corridor to remain unused and continue to burden the Santa Cruz taxpayers to sustain that corridor, just to sit there as an unused corridor, or even to allow a private tourist operator to use that corridor while our community needs it. So it's not a matter of what is on there, it's a matter of when. When will we use that corridor? And now with this new finding that the RTC, new to the RTC, we've communicated well for a while, for a decade, this shows that the ownership rights can be maintained through rail banking. And lastly, I just wanna thank Carrie Pinko again for bringing new evidence about the transportation patterns of our community. That wasn't part of the, that is very important information. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Rivas.
Chair Gonzalez, I do not see any other hands raised. Oh, there's one more. Ms. Arnold.
Ms. Arnold, would you like to speak on any item on the consent agenda only?
Yes, I just wanted to say...
Which item would you like to speak upon?
The rail banking issue. The Friends of the Rail and Trail recognizes that this is a very big issue, a very complex issue, and that it will require a lot of careful examination, and that it's appropriate for that to happen in the public eye because it is a publicly owned asset. And so we appreciate that this this issue is beginning to see some daylight. And we think that exploring the possibilities of rail banking would be well done within the context of a business plan for transit on the corridor. So we look forward to seeing some more public discussion on this issue in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms. Arnold.
Mr. Carl Kaplan, and then David Van Brink.
Hello, my name is Lawrence Kaplan. I live in Watsonville.
How are you doing, sir? What item would you like to speak from the consent agenda?
I'd like to speak about the rail and trail process.
That is not on the consent agenda item, sir.
It's item number 19. Number 19, you can speak then.
Number 19 then?
Yeah.
Yes.
Thank you.
You're welcome, sir.
I have a long history in the county, including a politics class at UCSC.
Sir, hate to interrupt you, but what item are you going to be speaking on the, we're on the consent agenda right now.
I'm sorry, I don't have a visual to the consent agenda.
You can find it on the website for RTC.
Perhaps you could just tell me if this is the appropriate time to talk about the rail and trail issue.
That you should come back on when it's item 19.
Thank you, I will do that.
Thank you, Carl, for your time.
Mr. Van Brink.
Good morning, can you hear me?
Yes, Mr. Van Brink, what item would you like to speak on?
Rail banking, of course. Like to remark that I'm reassured that rail banking is being carefully explored and analyzed. It's worth mentioning that in our community, there is a minority of quite vocal or even rabid transit opponents. Obviously, rail banking would be premature at this stage, and if executed in a vacuum, these rabid transit opponents will wildly mischaracterize the issue and attempt to exploit it. If executed without a specific plan going forward, they'll say that RTC has agreed to rule out transit on the corridor. So please continue planning forward and consider rail banking only within the context of an actual transit plan. Thanks.
Thank you, sir, for your time. Is there anybody else from the public like to speak on any item on the consent agenda?
Mr. Bud Colligan. And then someone that has Apple as their name.
Mr. Colligan, what item would you like to speak upon on the consent agenda?
You're muted, I guess.
Can you hear me now?
Yes.
Thank you, Chairman.
What item would you like to speak upon on the consent
agenda? I would like to speak on number 10. I would just like to point out to the commission, in case there are several new members here, that Friends of the Rail and Trail has consistently opposed rail banking for the last 6 years and said it was not possible. Now it appears that staff says it is appropriate and possible. So I know there's a lot of revisionist history with people that comment here, but it's important to note the facts of the situation. There are also many commissioners who have said it wasn't possible and not appropriate, and now it appears that it is. So rail banking has been implemented in hundreds of communities across the country. It is a tried and true method of saving and protecting public assets. And it should be viewed as it is appropriately as a legal means to save the corridor, preserve all the easements, and to put the liability of any takings lawsuits to the federal government and not have county liability. This has been true for the last 6 years, and it's good that both the commission and organizations that have said it was not true have now changed their tune. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for speaking.
Okay, someone that is calling themselves Apple.
I apologize for that. My name is Bill Cook. I live in Santa Cruz.
What item would you like to speak on the consent agenda?
Rail banking, please.
Okay, go ahead, sir.
Thank you. rail banking has been established for a very long time. It is the norm for the entire nation. This is the way these things done. Every other community that has ever approached any of these sorts of issues has used rail banking in order to do exactly what is being proposed by both sides on this issue. It's normative. It's under the absolute control of the Surface Transportation Board. They don't split hairs. It's abundantly clear. Their decisions are perfunctory and they do not reverse themselves. There's no risk. And it's the it's the normal way these things get done. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your comments.
Chair Gonzalez, I do not see any other hands.
Okay, one more last. Anybody from the public would like to speak on any item on the consent agenda? Seeing none, we're going to go ahead and move forward to the regular agenda. Commissioner's report.
I'll move approval of the consent agenda.
We did have a motion by Rotkins and a second by Jock. So roll call.
All right, Commissioner Bertrand.
I approve.
Commissioner Brown.
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson.
Aye.
Commissioner Montesino.
Aye.
Commissioner Caput.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Shiffrin.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Mulhern.
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
Aye.
Commissioner McPherson?
Aye.
Commission Alternate Myers?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
Commissioner Rotkin?
Aye.
Unanimously.
All right. Okay, now we're going to go ahead and move on. I apologize for that. Being new at this is this experience as itself. We're going to go ahead and move on to the regular agenda item. Item number 15, commissioner reports. Is there any oral commissioner's reports?
Mr. Chair?
Chair recognizes Mr. Conan. Did I say that right?
Yes, thank you, Mr. Chair. I would like to request that staff place an item on the March RTC agenda to, quote, consider direction to prepare a delivery plan for a wide multi-use trail in the middle of the corridor, including use of all existing trestles and bridges, end quote. We promised the public with Measure D that we would do a true analysis of the highest and best use of the corridor, and plan for this kind of trail has never been done. The rail trail is currently planned is largely unbuildable, particularly in the first district, and transit, we're seeing some of the issues with the TCAA. And so I think we owe it to ourselves and the public to consider a plan that we can build with the money we have. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Is there any other commissioner?
Mr. Bertrand?
I know this is a request that has to be honored by staff, but I would like to second the effort by Manu. I think this is an important consideration that needs due diligence so that the community and the RTC commissioners understand what the issue is and its impact. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Mr. Chair?
Yes, Mike?
As a procedural motion on, it's not a motion on the floor, but a suggestion to staff. And my question is, it's a procedural one to you or to the our legal support, whatever. I'm not against the idea of having these kinds of discussions, but the timing of them at our next meeting, when we're still engaged in a process that we've been involved in, first for 2 years studying generally and then more specifically about transit options, seems inappropriate. And I believe it's appropriate at some point before we just like leave that, you know, any member can request something, but I'd in fact like to see a formal motion to deny that suggestion and that leave it to staff when alternatively, as we go forward with this process, what other kinds of options are for. There may be questions, and I'm not going to, you know, I'm not pushing that we do any of these necessarily, but issues of whether we should have asked for information that might be helpful to a business plan for either a trail or for the rail, other kinds of questions, and to simply like stick in the, you know, a month from now, let's just undo the entire process of the last 2 years with agenda item does not seem productive to me. So I'll let you rule or others that I'm going to make a motion that we in fact not formally request that on the March agenda we discuss the question of throwing out the entire public transit discussion and have instead a discussion about a wider trail. It seems inappropriate. My motion is leave it to staff to figure when to bring us back various options around the entire use of the corridor question. That's my motion.
Thank you for that, Commissioner Ruck. You know, procedural wise, I had a question on that because, I mean, he's requesting to put something on the agenda to the future. During oral communications and oral reports. So it neither fell on neither one of those. It was neither a report. And so in our agenda packet, we don't have any item that we can add into future agenda items to address those. Is this still an appropriate place?
Just to clarify my question, Mr. Chair, I'm just suggesting that it's perfectly fine for a member of the commission to say, I'd like to have an item on the agenda, but to specify when it will appear on the agenda is inappropriate at this point. I mean, you can make a request, but it can't be seen as like the commission has approved this and the staff must follow that suggestion. So that's all I'm trying to do. Leave open, you know, again, people can suggest we ought to talk about items in the future, but to try and agendize them at the meeting, again, without a formal discussion seems inappropriate. That's my point.
Mr. Chair, what's our legal counsel say?
Hang on, that's what I want to hear from Steve.
So, Mr. Chair, members of the commission, the request is to agendize the consideration of a discussion on these issues. And so that is appropriate as part of commissioner reports and just in anticipation of potentially a second question. Commissioner Rockin's motion, which has not yet been seconded, as I understand,
that's correct,
is also appropriate because you're not discussing the substantive issue right now. The request is to add an item to the agenda so that you can consider providing that direction. So you're not having the substantive discussion today. You're really just trying to determine whether or not you're going to have an item on your agenda at the next meeting.
Okay. So I guess I take it. Do we have somebody that wants to speak on this?
Commissioner Mulhern?
Yeah. Yes, thank you. I just wanted to clarify what Commissioner Rodkin was saying, that we will have this discussion at staff's discretion according to their time and capabilities to put together a staff report and leave it to staff to agendize it in an expeditious manner according to their own capabilities.
That's my suggestion, Patrick.
So is there a second to Mr. Commissioner Rodkin's motion?
Yeah, I'll second that.
Please second that.
It was seconded by Mulhern.
Seconded by who?
Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
So, roll call.
So clarification of the question is that sure. Instead of at the March agenda or RTC meeting, it's simply at staff's discretion.
Yes, but that, you know, I'm not trying to block it coming to the agenda. I just don't think we can tell them, you know, you'd be ready in March to do this discussion. It might be a big one.
Yeah, that's a lot of work to cover in less than a month.
Commissioner Bertrand?
I approve.
Commissioner Brown?
Aye.
Commissioner Johnson?
No.
Commissioner Montesino?
Aye.
Commissioner Caput?
Aye.
Commission Alternate Schifrin?
Aye.
Commission Alternate Mulhern?
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
No.
Commissioner McPherson?
Virginia Johnson for McPherson, aye.
Commission Alternate Myers?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
Aye.
And Commissioner Rodkin?
Aye.
And we have three no's. Commissioner Schifrin has his hand up.
Is there any other commissioner that has?
Yes, I'd just like to add a request that when this comes back, we get a full report on the Unified Cordis Investment Study and the findings from that study, what that study entailed, and what the commission did with that study.
That's added to it, right?
That's just the request that, you know, as the request that this item be brought to the agenda, I think it is important to for the commission to review what decisions were made about the Unified Corridor Study and why it was done and what it found.
Okay, thank you. Is there any other commissioner that has a commissioner's report? Hearing none or seeing none? Jock, do you have a report?
Yeah, I just want to say that reaching out to the public, thank for your participation in giving your views on the issues on this agenda, and also in talking to my eligible Brown law members, excuse me, the ones that are provided by law that I could talk with. Thank you for that discourse. I appreciate the sharing of your ideas, and I respect the sharing of the ideas with those individual people. Some disagree with me and some agree with me, but that I think is part of our discussion, and it helps this commission work a lot better. So my kudos to fellow commissioners I talk with, and my kudos to the public who obviously put a lot of work into their ideas and trying to present it to the commission. And I assure the public that many of the commissioners read the emails. A little suggestion, response to Carrie Pico, I believe. If you have ideas that you want to get across in your 2 or 3 minutes, depending on the agenda, I think it would help the commissioners if we saw the work ahead of time so we could read it. And then, you know, when you do the presentation, we'd have a better idea of what's actually on your mind. I think that would help us tremendously. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. Is there any other commissioner would like to speak during oral communications? None? Hearing none and seeing none, we're gonna go ahead and move on to item 16, director's report.
Thank you, Chair Gonzalez and commissioners, and welcome Commissioner Montesino. I have just a couple items on my direct report today. The first item is regarding revenue forecast for Measure D and the Transportation Development Act. Since the beginning of the pandemic, RTC staff has been closely monitoring Measure D and TDA funds. We were expecting that both of these revenue sources would be significantly impacted by a drop in tax receipts. Based on initial projections, RTC passed a modified fiscal year 2021 budget in June of 2020, which reduced projected revenue of both Measure D and TDA funding to values 20% below actual fiscal year 18-19 receipts. And we used fiscal year 18-19 because that was the last year where we didn't have an effect by the pandemic. Measure D revenue is currently trending about 4% above actual fiscal year 18-19 receipts, and therefore it's now 22% above RTC's approved fiscal year 2021 budget. Similarly, TDA revenue is currently trending about 3% above actual fiscal year 18-19 receipts and 29% above RTC's approved fiscal year 2021 budget. In addition to the effects of the various economic stimulus legislation, we suspect that a good portion of this positive trend is due to online sales. And we're very fortunate to have had a court ruling known as the Wayfair decision. And that provided that states could mandate that businesses without a physical presence in a state with more than 200 transactions or $100,000 in state sales collect and remit sales taxes on transactions in the state. And California enacted AB 147, which required marketplace facilitators to collect and remit sales tax for use, consumption, and storage in California effective October 1, 2019, just before the pandemic. And that's a good reason why we were able to weather the storm, so to speak. So for Measure D, the actual Measure D revenue will pass directly to recipients for the neighborhood and transit program categories, so there's nothing we need to do. For regional Measure D categories, and those would be the highway corridor, MBSST, and rail, staff is considering appropriate estimates for this year's five-year programming cycle, which is currently under development and will come to the RTC for consideration later this year. We will also be considering whether to replenish the TDA reserve, which was impacted in fiscal year 19-20, and how best to ensure that the balance of TDA revenue, the amounts above budgeted amounts and reserve requirements, can be expeditiously distributed to eligible recipients. It is likely that TDA claims that were adjusted in June of 2020 can be at least partially, if not completely, restored to pre-pandemic levels.
I have one other update, and that's on the Short Line Railroad Improvement Program. On January, I reported a little bit on this last month based on the CTC staff's recommendation. Well, on October 28th, the CTC approved RTC's grant application request for $285,000 from the Short Line Railroad Improvement Program for the construction of the $670,000 Pajaro River Railroad Bridge Rehabilitation Project. RTC expects to request a construction allocation from the CTC this fall, with contract award estimated in March of 2022. So we'll see construction next year. RTC is matching the grant funding with $214,000 in Measure D and $171,000 in private fee and lease funding generated by RTC's ownership of the branch line. I provided a little bit more detail on what will be done in my report. Transportation planner Tommy Travers is managing this project for RTC, and he worked hard on the grant application as well as Ginger Dicar. That concludes my report today.
Thank you, Mr. Guy. Mr. Preston, is there any questions for the executive director from the commissioners on his report?
Thanks for the good news.
Yeah. I have one question in regards to the Pajaro Bridge and the work that we're going to do on that. You know, I understand that the Pajaro, the levee itself is going to be upgraded. Are we taking into consideration the work that's going to be done on the levee? Because they're going to be wanting to raise the elevation of the levee. And if we're going to invest all this money on rehabbing the bridge, I just thought we had that under consideration.
Staff is coordinating with the county. We are aware that there is a levee project, and we're making sure that that whatever we do corresponds with the other project being implemented by the county.
Thank you. Is there any other questions from the commissioners for the executive director? Seeing none, we're going to go ahead and move on to item.
We have public comment, Commissioner Gonzalez.
Okay, is there any, sorry about that. Is there any public comments or questions on the report from the executive director?
Mr. Peoples?
Chair recognizes Mr. Peoples.
Yes, hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Thank you. Just as a reminder, Trail Now, you know, when Measure D was first proposed, they had 24% of that going towards the train, and actually $14 million going towards a Monterey train station. We came out as a PAC and opposed Measure D, and fortunately, Don Lane and Zach Friend changed the language and actually shifted the money from the train to Metro and actually eliminated the train station out of Monterey. And we came back and was a big supporter. And actually, the majority of our supporters provided most of the funds, the highest amount of funds to get Measure D. So we're really happy that that Measure D is gaining that. One of the points I want to highlight in the additional literature that was sent was from Roaring Camp. They're a private train operator, and there's no requirement from the Surface Transportation Board to accommodate a private train operator connected to a public transit railroad. So we want to make sure that the RTC, you know, communicates that there's no obligation for the public owned property to accommodate Roaring Camp. We want to make sure that we recognize that. And then finally, I want to ask the question, this Pajaro trestle, is that within our branch line? Does that fall within our branch line? I wasn't sure if that's within it. Okay, Guy, thank you for nodding your head, and I appreciate that. And it would be great if you could put a trail on that next to it on that while you're doing the upgrades. I hope that you're including that, because the Watsonville would benefit a lot from allowing the public to have a passage there. Over. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Peoples. Is there anybody else from the public that'd like to ask a question on the executive director's report?
Chair Gonzalez, I do not see any other hands raised.
Thank you. We're going to go ahead and move on to item.
Commissioner Bertrand is trying to speak.
Yes, Commissioner.
Yeah, Mr. Chair, if you may, if I may, the last public comment raised a question to me, and I was wondering if I could address it to our legal counsel. And the question is, does a private entity, rail or whatever, have any rights over us in terms of providing service? Do we have to provide that connection to them because they're a private entity rather than a public entity? I'm just trying to understand what was brought up by.
There is, you know, to the extent that, Roaring Camp has common carrier status for their line that they own, there is an obligation. Obligation may be slightly too strong a word. It is part of the national rail system, and it is something that, as Roaring Camp has indicated in their letter, they would like to continue to be connected to that. There are procedures under the STB involving abandonment and rail banking where those issues are actually looked at, determine whether or not you're still able to, for instance, in the case of Roaring Camp, be able to get locomotives to where they actually operate at right now. And so those are issues that are looked at as part of the abandonment and rail banking process.
Okay, thank you. Yeah, the moving of locomotives has me interested. It seems to me you can move those on the highway too, but thank you for that question answer.
Thank you, Commissioner. Seeing no more hands, we're going to go ahead and move on to item 17, Caltrans report. Mr. Tidden, you're on.
All right. Thank you, Chair, Commissioners. For the commissioners I haven't met or the members of the public, my name's Tim Gubbins. I am the District Director of Caltrans District 5, so here on the Central Coast. We do have, as usual, our Caltrans report as part of your agenda packet. In the interest of time, I won't go over any of those or some of perhaps my usual reports, but I did want to just make this board aware that Caltrans, my staff has been working very closely with staff throughout your county. And in the county OES, the preparations for the evacuations that had to happen with the storms, as well as all the preparations we were doing before the storms. We are very fortunate that the storm kind of hit Santa Cruz, moved a little to the south. Highway 236 through Big Basin State Parks remains closed. But we're fairly fortunate with just minor damage in most of the other places. The county to your south, Monterey County, I believe everyone's probably aware since it's been in the news everywhere nationally. In Big Sur, in the area of the Dolan Fire went from August to December of last year. Caltrans similarly had been working with Monterey County on doing a lot of preventative work, cleanup of debris, redundant drainage systems. And the good news is that most of the drainage systems then passed the water and debris flow. We had minor to significant damage that we're now cleaning up. But the most significant damage happened post mile 30, which is just a couple miles south of the Esalen Institute. If you guys need a thing, at a place called Rat Creek, we actually lost both lanes of Route 1. So Route 1 is currently impassable in Monterey County. We have contractors out there right now cleaning up the debris, finding the drainage systems that were buried under the mud, working on solutions to figure it out. We are firmly entrenched in the assessment, and we are working very closely with Monterey County to move the closures from the north and the south to just as close as we can to where the roadway is missing. We do not yet know how long it will be closed or what the solution is, whether we need to go to a structural fix. But since you are a neighboring county, I just wanted to bring that to your attention and let you know, as we all know, the traffic coming up from Monterey affects this county in both tourism and other areas. So that's my report for the day. I would be happy to entertain any questions.
Thank you, Tim. Is there any questions from the commission? Rim?
Yes, I have a question.
Go ahead, Andy. The chair recognizes you. That's Andy, right?
Yes, thank you. I have a question regarding the encampment of homeless unhoused individuals at the intersection of Highway 1 and Highway 9 in the city of Santa Cruz. Commissioner Cooney has received numerous concerns about that encampment. The land is owned, as I understand it, by Caltrans, and there's it's unclear to the extent to which Caltrans is working with the city of Santa Cruz to respond to some of the concerns there. And I wonder, one, if I know this might be a new issue for you, Mr. Gubbins, so I don't want to put you on the spot, but I would ask you at the next meeting to provide an update on what the what Caltrans.
Okay, I stopped hearing you, Andy, and so if the chair would like, I can start addressing the concern I heard.
Yeah, unless Andy, okay. Is that wrapped it up, Andy? Do you hear us?
Yes.
Okay. Thank you. This is not a new issue. We are well aware. I can bring information back. People experiencing homelessness in this state is a very large issue that has grown tremendously, especially in the last year with the pandemic and the economic situation we have. But also with the pandemic, there are protocols out there as far as health and safety of the general public and all of our workers. And so when we work in and around encampments, there is additional care taken. And with the governor's administration, we're trying to make sure we're following all CDC and other public health guidelines when we are actually removing encampments from our right of way, as well as making sure that there's an opportunity to help lift these people up into a better situation for themselves and for society. And so I can come back and provide exactly what we can do. We have been in communication with the city. There are plans there. I think everyone on this call is probably aware of some of the situations that are happening in this city and county and in all my counties and throughout the state. But this is a very serious issue. We take it seriously. We understand both sides of issues, and I'll bring something back.
I appreciate hearing that, and I'm sorry I got my internet connection got messed up. The county also is providing services, as I understand it, to the area. So as part of your report next month, maybe you could talk about the nature of the interaction with both the city and the county in your response. So thank you very much.
Yes, thank you for bringing that up, because as you know, we are not a social service agency. However, we are servants of the state. So it all blends together, and we do look for that partnership at the local level before we take major action. So thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, and thank you, Mr. Gibbs. Is there any other fellow commissioner that has questions? Donna Myers, chair recognizes Donna Myers. Commissioner Donna Myers. Donna, you need to unmute yourself.
Yeah, thank you, Director Gubbins. I wear two hats this morning, and I appreciate Commissioner Schifrin's questions. He had asked the question I had. I'm also the mayor of the city of Santa Cruz, and I'm also the Metro alternate representing the Metro Transit. And I appreciate your comments about the Highway 1 and 9. And would very much like to encourage a report back to this commission next month. We also in the city are planning a major construction project at Highway 1 and 9, an improvement project there at that intersection, which is a very dangerous intersection in our community. So we would appreciate and know the difficult situation you're in as an agency. But also just speaking from the Highway 9 corridor, we do see people moving up towards the transit district office and facilities are also along along Highway 9. And so the whole area is heavily impacted, and your assistance from the state with regards to the issue there we would very much like to and actually need to get to resolution pretty soon, because we do need to get in and start building a major intersection improvement there. So I appreciate your time being here with us today, and I look forward to the report next month.
Thank you, Commissioner. And again, with the permission of the chair, I may suggest that it would be more productive so we can have a more substantial conversation. Perhaps you and I and even Commissioner Coonerty can meet independently. The report to this commission could just be very, very quick then, and we could get into more of the substantive issues if that fits with your. Thank you.
Yeah, thank you.
I think that would be very acceptable to Commissioner Coonerty. And how should we follow up? How can we make that happen?
I will instruct my assistant to reach out to both of the offices. And if you would like, you may also email me, and my assistant will start working on scheduling that with the Commissioner Meyer and Coonerty.
Thank you.
Okay.
Is that it, Andy?
Yes, although I see
Johnson's
hand, it might be good to invite Commissioner McPherson as well to that meeting.
That was going to be my request, Mr. Chair, and Tim, if you would please invite the McPherson office, we'd appreciate it. Thank you.
Thank you. Commissioner recognizes Commissioners Mrs. Brown, Sandy Brown.
Yeah, I just wanted to add, I appreciate the questions and the information you've given us. I would also be interested in participating in that conversation, given that I am the regular city representative, and Mayor Myers will be participating in this meeting, but it would be nice to have somebody who's kind of consistently here at the RTC to participate as well. So if you could reach out to me as well, or just include me in the email, that'd be great.
Thank you, Commissioner. So did you get that, Mr. Gibbs? You have 4 requests.
Yep. Yes, sir.
Okay. Is there any fellow commissioners that'd like to have any questions on the Caltrans report, Mr. Gibbs? No? Seeing no hands or hearing no voices. Thank you for your report. Thank you for your time. Thank you for your dedication to the state and to the community.
Commissioner Gonzalez, we have public comment.
Go ahead, and I'll open it up to the public for questions of the report. Only questions to the report.
Hi, this is Brian from Trail Now. Thank you, Mr. Gobins. Question, I'm in actually Florida right now. So I'm really pleased about being forced to the future and being able to join in on this Zoom call. But what's interesting is I rented a car, and it's a new car technology. The cars, stop themselves, right? The technology is just screaming ahead, vehicle technology. And actually I was driving through, I kid you not, driving through a neighborhood and the car stopped. I almost hit an alligator. I kid you not. And so my question is to you is, is Caltrans looking at vehicle technology on your investment, your capital investments? And I think the best example is the alligator almost getting hit. Now the alligators don't get hit because the cars stop. And so for example, we're looking at spending millions of dollars for this animal tunnel under Laurel Curve. We don't have a lot of money, so I suspect that's going to be delayed for a while. Would you envision that some projects that Caltrans sees today would fall to the wayside because of vehicle technology, where cars are driving themselves, people are out of the equation, animals are safer, motorcyclists are safer because cars are virtual, trains. They're virtual trains. That's essentially what cars are becoming. Thank you. Over.
Thank you, Mr. Peebles. Do you want to answer that?
Yeah, with Chair's discretion, I'll give just a quick answer. The quick answer is yes, Caltrans is very engaged in automated technology and, vehicle to vehicle, vehicle to infrastructure type of things. We're looking at the future on that. We also weigh with automation, we don't want to see a bunch of cars driving themselves to and from and actually increasing the number of trips. And so we're trying to be careful of that. But there are some test areas in the state. Contra Costa County and San Diego have some different test beds for those. So we are taking that into account. However, when the total, it's also a matter of timing of when the total fleet would flip over to some of these more modern cars and whether you have to accommodate all of those as well as everything else. And so there are quite a few things going on. So yes, we do take that into account in our expenditures.
We also have Tom and Susan Haidt.
Yeah, hi. Thank you all for your service here.
Go ahead, you have 2 minutes. Yes.
Okay.
Any questions?
So I just wanted to make a comment on the homeless encampment on the corner of River Street and Highway 1. So it's interesting, a friend of mine who was visiting here with me, we're going around, we're looking at Santa Cruz here and there, and he said, well, this is interesting that you have the homeless camp directly on the one of the main entrances right into Santa Cruz. It's good that you people are not trying to hide the situation that's going on and you're putting it right in our face. Well, I told him, you know, this is not what we're trying to do. It's that these people have gotten to this position, which many ways they've gotten this position, but there is no, where do they go? That's what we're talking about here. They wind up on the corner of that highway because the city has not found a place where these people can actually live. Thousands of people, and this continues to go on and it grows, especially with this COVID-19. Many people have lost their homes, lost their jobs. Families are on the streets. Family can't afford food. They wind up on the corner of River Street and Highway 1. It is disgraceful that the city... that the city will somehow not find a place for these people to stay. I've been to the River Street encampment behind the county building. It's a complete disaster and mess. I work with these people all the time, and the city has to step up and do something. It is absolutely dangerous, horribly dangerous for these people to be camping on the side of a highway. So I would like something done about this. What happens if a car careens off that highway and runs into those tents and kills those people? What happens? Who is?
Thank you, sir, for your time and your comments.
All right. Well, thank you,
Commissioner Gonzalez. I do not see any other hands raised.
Seeing no more hands, we're going to go ahead and move on to the next agenda item, which is agenda item number 18, which is the committee appointments to the Budget and Administration Personnel, California Association of Councils of Government, CALCOG, and Coast Rail Coordinating Council, CRCC. We're going to go ahead and start with a staff report.
Yes, good morning, Commissioners. Yesenia Parra of your staff. Historically, each February, commissioners are asked to inform the commission chair or the executive director of their interest to be re-elected or elected to serve on an RTC committee. Currently, the Budget and Administration Personnel Committee is your only standing commission committee. So staff recommends that commissioners please notify the Chair Gonzalez or Executive Director Preston of your interest in serving on the BNA by February 17th. Appointments to this committee will be made at our March meeting. The RTC also holds membership on 2 external committees, CALCOG and the Coastal Rail Coordinating Council. Your 2020 RTC representative to CALCOG was Commissioner Zach Friend, and Mr. John Leopold served on the CRCC. So commissioners should also inform the chair or executive director of their interest to continue to serve or to be appointed to one of these external committees by February 17th. And again, all these appointments will be made at our March RTC meeting. Thank you.
Thank you, Yesenia. Is there any questions from the commissioners?
I just wanted to point out that no action is needed on this item.
Yeah, exactly. There is no action. And there has been given direction by staff what needs to be done. See none? We're going to go ahead and move on to item 19, the Transit Corridor Alternative Analysis and Rail Network Integration Study, final draft report and locally preferred alternative. I want to bring up something to the commission in regards to allowing the public to speak on this item. I'd like to get a consensus that we only allow those that have not spoken on this agenda item, since we did have a public hearing and there was quite a few people that had spoken on that item already. Commissioner Rodkin. You're muted, Commissioner. Commissioner Rodkins, you're muted.
I know. Okay. Sorry. I just wanted to say that's a ruling you can make, and unless there's a vote to overrule you, you can decide, make that decision.
Okay.
And I support what you're doing. Unless anybody opposes it, just go ahead.
Thank you very much. So we're going to go ahead and we're going to proceed with item 19, and I'm only going to allow those that have not spoken on this item to speak. And I will be giving them 2 minutes when it comes to the public portion. So we'll go ahead and with staff, I guess.
Thank you. I have a slide presentation, if you can put up, Yesenia.
Having technical difficulties here with these slides, so I'm going to try and do my best to show it as a presentation. Otherwise, I think I'm going to have to just scroll through the slides.
Well, if you open it first and then open share screen, it will work. There you go.
Yeah, it doesn't. Oh, there we go. Okay, got it.
Thank you, Yesenia. Good morning, Chair, Commissioners, and members of the public. I'm Ginger Dikar, Senior Transportation Planner on RTC staff. The item before you today is a Transit Corridor Alternatives Analysis and Rail Network Integration Study. The objective of this study is to evaluate transit investment options that utilize the Santa Cruz Branch rail line. The staff report is a continuation of the staff report that was presented to the Commission on the January 14th meeting. The oral report for this item was presented at this previous meeting. Today, I'll provide just a brief overview of the project. And also, there are a number of members of the project team here today to answer any additional questions. RTC and Metro staff have been working together with HDR Engineering and Farron Pierce on this analysis. We have, in the meeting today, we have Steve Decker, who is the program manager for this project at HDR. I believe Pam Yomkins from HDR, I know she had some other things scheduled, but she may be able to be on this meeting as well. Alan Wang from Farron Pierce. From Metro staff, we have John Ergo, Pete Rasmussen, Wandabu Menginstu, and Matt Marquez. We also have Caltrans Division of Rail staff, Kyle Gratinger and Shannon Simons, and many members of RTC staff to help answer any questions you may have today. Next slide, please. Today, the project team is recommending that the RTC adopt the resolution that accepts the Transit Corridor Alternatives Analysis and Rail Network Integration Study, which selects electric passenger rail as the locally preferred alternative. Why electric passenger rail for the Santa Cruz Branch Rail Line? The future vision for transportation in Santa Cruz County includes fully utilizing the Santa Cruz Branch Rail Line for both transit and a trail to develop an integrated transit network throughout the county. RTC purchased this rail right-of-way for transportation solutions. Let's fully utilize this resource for both transit and trail, with rail being the superior transit solution. The Santa Cruz Branch Line is the only readily available facility in the county that can be dedicated to transit and not shared with other vehicle uses that would delay travel times. Rail transit will provide a fast, safe, and accessible option for travel for both residents and visitors, and will improve quality of life. By improving transit travel times, Transit becomes a much more realistic option for people to travel through Santa Cruz County without wasting time and experiencing the stress of sitting in congested traffic. Rail transit provides equitable, independent accessibility for people of all ages and abilities to travel. People who can't afford to own a vehicle or prefer not to drive, people who are younger than the driving age, and seniors and people with disabilities. Rail transit advances greenhouse gas emission reduction goals. Our community has been feeling the drastic impacts of climate change, such as increased wildfires and potential for mudslides and more extreme droughts. The time is now to transition to clean energy transportation solutions. Proactive planning and investment in reducing climate impacts is much less expensive than funding disaster recovery. The California State Rail Plan outlines a strategy for developing a state-of-the-art rail system. It is important that Santa Cruz County is not left behind. Let's decide that Santa Cruz County should be part of this vision. Rail service along the Santa Cruz branch line will connect the Santa Cruz region into the statewide rail network. Your decision today whether to select rail as a locally preferred transit alternative for the Santa Cruz branch line will be represented in the California State Rail Plan update for 2022, which will affect the ability to obtain funding for this project. Transit projects that provide greenhouse gas emission reductions and serve transportation disadvantaged communities are the types of projects that state and federal funding programs are looking to fund. Next slide, please. The next steps of this project are to develop a business plan for the locally preferred alternative. This business plan will provide a 25-year plan for implementation and operations and maintenance of the locally preferred alternative. It will provide information on the governance options for how transit could be administered. It will provide the steps for implementation that are needed to deliver the project and a cash flow analysis for funding these implementation steps. The business plan is scheduled to be brought to the RTC at the RTC April meeting. And before I close, I want to thank the many people who have been engaged in this discussion about how best to use the Santa Cruz Branch Rail Line. It has been quite a lively discussion with input from so many members of our community. With that, I'm happy to take any questions or comments. Thank you.
Thank you, Ginger. Thank you for that report. Is there any questions from the fellow commissioners?
I just had a process question.
Go ahead, Commissioner. Sure.
I understand the direction from the chair to try to limit public comment to folks we haven't heard from, but I'm just curious in council's opinion of whether or not we can actually legally stop anyone from making a comment at this time if they would like to.
The commission did conduct a public hearing last time, so the public has had an opportunity to speak on the issue of the TCAA and the recommendation to proceed with a business plan. So I think you can limit the comments to just those who have not spoken before, or actually not even take any public comments, but that's not what is being considered right now.
Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Myers.
Thank you, Chair. I have a question just about the business plan. I'm wondering about, you mentioned it would come back to the commission in April. I'm wondering about, is there a public process around that, or how is that business plan developed with regards to public input?
So I can start that, and any of the other project team members can add to it. The business plan is going to be based on the information that has been provided in the report already, the cost estimates, as well as the funding sources that did go through a public process. And, the additional steps in this plan, I feel, are more of a technical basis to bring to the commission. We can take input at the April meeting from commissioners and other stakeholders.
Thank you.
Is there any other commissioners that has any other questions?
Yes.
I seen one back there. OK,
I have my hand up. I think Jacques does as well.
I recognize Commissioner Johnson, alternate Johnson.
Thank you, Chair. I just also have a process question. I don't have any questions for staff. Thank you, though, very much for all your work and the consultants. But I want to make sure that that the commissioners have an opportunity to make comments after public comment. If that's your intent, Mr. Chair, that'd be great. Thank you.
We can do that. Right now, we're just in questions on the study. Is there any, Commissioner Rodkins?
So my question's about the comment that we just had about bringing back the business plan in April. Am I correct in my assumption that in such a business plan, we would simply be bringing forward the numbers in terms of the cost of alternatives, since that's the business plan that's being proposed, bringing forward the numbers from the Unified Corridor Study and the TCAA, rather than developing numbers in terms of what the actual cost of a rail system would be? And let me make that clear why I'm asking this question. My understanding, I could be wrong and please correct me, is that the cost of rail alternatives is a kind of a conglomerate number that comes out of looking at a wide range of different kinds of rail systems, light rail systems down to trolleys and so forth. If in fact seems to me that a business plan needs to be based on what actual costs would be to create something. And we know, let's say, for example, the commission decides that rail is our preferred alternative. It's still not clear whether we're talking about a light rail system, which is relatively expensive, versus a trolley or tram system, smaller scale kind of thing. The whole issue of whether, what I'm asking about is the basis for building a business plan. Do we have sufficient information? Or if we wanted to get a more specific business plan focused on a particular technology, and I'm not endorsing this, but the TIGM system or something like it or some other particular actual system that's available, we would probably end up with, I assume we would end up with different numbers for the cost of rail, and therefore the business plan, it could be a dramatic difference. I mean, perhaps half the cost of the average cost of rail or something. I'd have no idea. So my question to staff is, are we actually in a position to do a business plan? If we do one, is it simply going to be based on rolling over the numbers from a generic rail system that we've been studying? Or would this actually put some new numbers into what rail options are before us in a real way? Is the question clear?
I believe so. Let me try and answer and see if I hit on your question here. So the business plan will be based on the transit card alternatives analysis cost estimates for both a light rail system and a commuter rail system, if that's the decision made today, that they are both the locally preferred alternative. Those
numbers would be, again, for the, say, light rail system, I assume that's a much more expensive system, say, than a trolley system or a smaller tram system. But we'd be making our business plan based on the assumption that we're building this sort of generic rail plan. Am I correct?
It would be based on, the business plan would be based on a light rail system and a commuter rail system. Yes.
Commissioner Rodkin, there was a huge difference between those two cost estimates. You're correct in that it would be somewhat generic in nature, but the concepts are going to be the same with respect to delivery of the project, needing environmental clearance, needing to fund environmental clearance, needing to fund the capital improvements, and then needing to fund operations and maintenance. When I worked for the High Speed Rail Authority, they were producing business plans every 2 years. They didn't have environmental clearance project level for all of their projects. Cost estimates were adjusted, and the plan was updated each year as more information became available. You can produce a business plan now. A business plan later will have greater accuracy. You can certainly revise the business plan at a periodic timetable.
Thank you for that response, both of you.
And Chair, I have additional questions.
Commissioner Myers, go ahead.
Sorry, got to plug in my computer. I just have maybe, I didn't know if we were going to get just new to your process a little bit here. I do have some specific questions regarding some of the costs in the report. Is it appropriate that I kind of go through those now. It does relate to my question around the business plan, but I do see some, I like to express that there's some concerns around how those numbers will continue through the process of estimation for the passenger rail service. Is now an appropriate time to get some of these questions from the staff answered, or should we wait till after public comment? You would like to do that now?
No, okay. It's when the questions for the study.
Great, thank you, Chair. So I think, Ginger, this would be to you, and thank you again for the presentation this morning. In the TCAA study, it's noted that the annual operating cost for rail service is estimated to be $25 million per year. But in looking at that report, and I'm a bit new to all of this, but I did try to do as much of my homework as possible, I couldn't find a sort of a detailed breakdown on what exactly is in that figure. And so I just wanted to understand the relationship between the numbers in the uniform corridor study and how they were either changed or not changed going into the TCAA. So that's kind of a broader question. And then I also have a question around table B10 in the passenger rail service in the, that's in the uniform corridor study. But when I add the $13 million for operation for rail and the $12 million operational cost for additional bus service, that comes to the $25 million. And I'm just trying to understand where those numbers are coming from, I guess is what my main question on that. Trying to understand the UCS study and how those numbers moved into the TCAA study.
Sure, I'll be happy to start with the answer to that question, and then I'll hand it off to Steve Decker, who's the project manager at HDR. But there is a significant difference between the estimates for the operations and maintenance between the Unified Corridor Study and the alternatives analysis. And it's based, the difference comes mainly because the HDR team feels like many more vehicles would be needed than what were previous estimates for the operations of the rail system, which is if you increase the number of vehicles, then that's that would affect the total revenue hours. But with that, I'll hand it off to Steve and he can provide more information.
Thanks, Ginger. Hopefully you guys can hear me. I believe I'm off mute.
Yeah.
we got you.
So based on what Ginger said, certainly we did not help prepare the UCS cost estimates, but we certainly worked with them in this TCAA process. And in particular with the operations and maintenance costs, there are a few things that we added that were not included in the previous analysis that provide some of that difference we're talking about. And Ginger mentioned the number of vehicles. I think the UCS is at 3 vehicle train sets and we're at 5 with ours. So that increased the operating expenses a bit. And then we also looked at full weekend services, some bridge maintenance issues, this thing called positive train control in terms of improving and ensuring safety, et cetera, with safety mechanisms with the operations of the train. So some of those costs were not included in the UCS. And I would say the positive train control may not have been required at that time. They may have been, but they certainly are now. So there are a few things in there that we refined, and I think Ginger hit it on the head with the number of trains providing, covering the service frequencies that we identified in the plan, make up a lot of that difference.
Okay.
Hopefully that makes sense.
Yeah, that's helpful. Thank you. The one thing I guess that just really popped out for me, and especially as a member of the Metro Board, was that, this the calculation of the increasing bus service combined with the rail, just really looks as a tremendous public transit benefit. So I'm pleased to see some of these things being a little bit more realized in terms of the actual overall public transit benefit that we're looking to achieve here via the study. My other question had to do with, I'll ask one of these questions a little bit later on. Let's see here. Let me just double check my notes here on my questions. The other thing was on countywide transit ridership. So in the TCAA report, transit ridership performance measure coming from table 5-19, that the BRT bus alternative was predicted to result in countywide transit ridership of 37,500 daily boardings, about 9% more than the 34,300 predicted daily boardings for the light rail option. And then I also noticed in the Unified Corridor Investment Study that adding the BRT bus service to the rail corridor as part of Scenario C was predicted to increase the countywide public transit mode share to only 4.8%, while adding rail transit as part of Scenario B was predicted to increase the countywide public transit mode share to 6%. So when I do the math, looking at all that using the uniform corridor study figures, it looks like the countywide transit use will increase 25% more if rail is implemented than if the BRT bus is implemented. The result would not decrease as the TCAA predicts. So could you explain the apparent differences? I'm hoping that, I know I'm getting into a lot of details here.
Happy to do my best to explain the details. Okay. All the numbers and figures in front of me. I did see this comment presented by a member of the public. But it really is a little challenging to compare the results of the Unified Corridor study when we were looking at scenarios of a number of different projects versus in the alternatives analysis, we're focusing on the Santa Cruz Branch rail line. And so when you do the travel demand modeling work for the Unified Corridor study where we had scenarios, there were a number of different projects that were being implemented in a future year that were combining together to create a different dynamic for the number of people driving versus the number of people taking transit. And so it is challenging to compare directly because of, you know, just what I said, the scenarios, group projects, there's a number of them that are affecting those numbers. Obviously, there's typically a synergy between the more transit you provide, and we've heard this from Metro staff, and often the more ridership you can get because you have a better, more integrated transit network developed for people to get where they need to go. That said, I do think the bus rapid transit analysis and the alternatives analysis had more detailed effort done on it in comparison to the Unified Corridor study. It did show more ridership in this analysis than we were able to determine from the Unified Corridor study. And I think that's thanks to FAIR and Peers and the work they did and really bringing a lot of different tools together to be able to evaluate transit for the BRT. And some of that is because of the BRT being on SoCal and having the ability to have those shorter trips, the BRT alignment that we evaluated in the alternatives analysis. So again, challenging to compare the differences between the two studies.
Okay, great. Thank you very much for that. I guess I've got two very quick, again, math questions here. So if I'm looking at the 34,300 countywide transit ridership estimate for the LRT figure by 365 days a year, I come up with an annual countywide transit ridership figure of just over 12 million trips.
knowing the current annual countywide transit ridership is about 5 million. Am I really seeing what I think is quite a significant increase in annual public transit ridership as a potential result of the project? It looks substantial, somewhere around 7.5 million more. Is that, am I doing the math right on that?
I have to. Maybe you can send your spreadsheet over and I can check your math.
Okay.
I am a numbers person. I love that. I haven't done that analysis myself. I'm sorry. There's lots of different ways to kind of reconfigure these numbers. And I haven't done that one yet. We are forecasting for 2040. So there is a difference there from, where we are with 2020. So we need to always be mindful of that. There are not substantial changes to our roadway structure to develop any kind of increased capacity for growth, population growth. And so, this, when we're looking in the alternatives analysis, the increased capacity is through transit.
Through transit, okay.
Yes.
Well, that's significant. And again, just as we really look forward to the benefits to our community more over the generations, those numbers are pretty compelling to try to peel apart and tease together in terms of benefits. I just have one last question, and that's really, the metro budget is about 50 million and we carry about 5 million a year right now. And I just wanna see if there's also sort of a benefit to Metro's budget by obviously seeing this system come into place. I won't name numbers, but it would look like we would have significant increase in ridership, so therefore our budget would be going up as well. So I'm seeing you're nodding your head. Great. Well, that's very helpful in terms of just a perspective as a Metro board member, and I appreciate you answering my questions. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. The chair recognizes Commissioner Caput and then Commissioner Beltran. You have any questions on the study?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks a lot, Aurelio. And my early impression of all this, I like it. I think we need to look into it. And some of the questions you can just answer yes or no. But anyway, and I may have missed something in the report, but we're talking about Davenport all the way to Watsonville, right? Pomeroy.
The study area for the alternatives analysis for passenger rail is from the west side of Santa Cruz to Pajaro. So okay. Natural Bridges Drive right on the west side, close to the city limits.
Okay, and when we're talking, this is electric, but it's without the wires above, right? Is that correct?
Correct, that's what we're looking towards, yes.
Is there a third rail, like watch out for the hot electrical rail?
That is not what we're looking towards, not having a third rail.
No, okay. And the other would be, where and maybe how many nationally is this being actually done? And where would be the closest one? I keep thinking of BART, but BART is different. It has a third rail, it's electric and all that, but this is different. So what we're, Ginger, what you and Steve are talking about here, nationally, where are they doing it? In a lot of places or just a few, or is it brand new and we don't know what's going on yet?
I can start that and then I'll pass it on to Steve. He's the rail vehicle expert. But it is, we are counting on technology advances in the next decade that would help us be able to provide a system that would be clean energy solution, whether battery, hydrogen fuel cell, that type of thing. I think there's some out there, but it is really changing rapidly. With that, I'd hand it off to Steve.
Yeah, down in San Bernardino County, there's a system that extends from Metrolinx called the Redlands Passenger Rail. And that study, that passenger rail, it's probably about 9 or 10 miles long, commuter rail. It just was constructed. They are now going through an assessment of implementing, changing the equipment from DMU, which is diesel multiple unit, to hydrogen cells. So they're going through that study now. My firm's involved in that as well. So that is certainly very encouraging, and it and technology has improved significantly. So that would be no catenaries, nothing above, or no third rail, and that would be hydrogen cell powered. There are other studies going on nationally to get cleaner zero emission vehicles out there, not just with cars like we talked about earlier with Mr. Gubbins from Caltrans, but also with rail vehicles. So it is happening, and the technology is increasing rapidly.
Okay, but it's still new, and when we're looking at this, it would include freight. Would freight be able to go on the same line?
I'm happy to take that. So definitely freight would be able to. That's what we've been looking towards in the alternatives analysis. We have not received any other direction from the commission at this point to not consider freight.
Okay, that is still early. But I guess that my final one is basically, do we have to tear up the old line in order to put in a new line? Or is it, you know, that's all part of the cost. And so, is the old line gonna be, you know, the conventional passenger train? That's gonna be gone, and it'll be all or nothing.
So the cost estimates for the rail options did include replacing the rail. I believe it's 100%, and I think 75% of the ties would need to be replaced. That was the estimate for, that was included in the cost.
Okay, and I guess in April, when we're going forward, we'll be voting on actually making this alternative plan our primary plan, or are we just going to be approving, looking at both conventional passenger rail and freight and this plan also? We'll still be looking at both of them.
So the business plan decision, we'll be looking at just the passenger rail as an extension of the transit card alternatives analysis.
Okay. And I'll be, in the future, I'll be talking to Aurelio and Eduardo because they're Watsonville, and trying to get their ideas on what's good for Watsonville and South County. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Caput. Commissioner Beltran? Chair recognizes you. Do you have any questions?
Yes, I do. Thank you very much, Chair. So Donna sort of spoke to the questions that I had. And in general, it's the analysis portion of the business plan that you're going to be presenting if we approve to go ahead on this. And so my question to you, Ms. Dicar, is the business plan going to make these financing questions on the level of actual improvements and the ongoing expense apparent so that the public could get a clear idea of what we're actually talking about? Up to now, we have multiple studies and, you know, various tables, you know, in the studies, and, you know, a person has to go through these studies and compare and, you know, do the math and stuff like that, which I think is asking a lot of the general public. And, you know, some people are good in numbers. Donna apparently is, and you are definitely good with numbers, and thank you for being on the staff. But I want an analysis, and I want to have something that the public can understand so they could actually be appreciative of the total cost to do the implementation and the total cost to this community as we go forward so that we could afford it on a long going basis. So that's my question to you, and then I have one other question after that.
So again, I'll give a start here, and Steve and Guy can chime in as needed. The business plan is really trying to detail out either a year by year or a short-term, mid-term, long-term for how the funding would come together for implementing the locally preferred alternative. And so it's kind of stepping through where, you know, what kind of grant programs are we going to be going after? What are the various different steps we need to take in order to just go through the implementation? And so I think it really will give kind of a roadmap for implementing the locally preferred alternative.
But from the presentation of staff, I want to make sure that this is something the public can understand. Is this going to be focused on the general public being able to use it when they make their decisions when it comes to the ballot? Because a lot of this is going to be needing public support on the ballot.
Well, Commissioner Bertrand, I really appreciate your input on thinking about how we can provide some maybe fact sheets or dashboard type of materials that would go along with a more technical report. And that's a great thing for us to consider.
I think that's highly critical because the public needs to be supportive of this if it's even going to go forward. My second question is, and you sort of alluded to grants, et cetera, that would be state, maybe federal, stuff like that. And what kind of moving forward, you know, when you get this proposal approved, if it is approved, what kind of grants and such are you going to be talking about? And what kind of amounts are those? Are they, I'm just trying to get an idea what that portion of the business plan is.
So as far as the funding sources, there is one of the appendices in the back of the report lays out the funding sources that we're looking towards to help implement this project. And there is amounts in there that are assumed, and it'll be that information that we'll be utilizing in the business plan. There are a number of different sources. I don't really have it on the tip of my tongue of what those are, both state and federal sources.
Yeah, I did look at that table. Yes, for doing studies mostly, but, you know, basically to get us an idea of how to move forward. But, you know, okay, thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner. The chair recognizes Commissioner Brown.
Thank you, Chair Gonzalez. I just wanted to follow up on the question and the response, Commissioner Rotkin's question about the potential for, and I think others have been getting at this, the potential for getting accurate assessments, cost assessments, given all of the unknowns, new technologies, and alternative possibilities for getting us to, a clean rail, light rail, and or trolley or something else alternative. And so I guess I'm not being well versed in the content and purpose of business. Well, I understand the purpose, but kind of how business plans are developed. It seems to me that because we don't have a clear plan, that I'm just wondering, is there another step that could be in, maybe a pre-business plan or something like that, that isn't really spending a lot of energy and time on something that we may not end up, pursuing. So I guess I'm wondering what your thoughts are about that. And I know this was in response to a request from the CTC, so I don't want to minimize the, rationale for it, but just wondering about that possibility.
So, we do realize that this is a planning study, that our cost estimates are based on it being a planning study. The further you go in implementing a project, getting through environmental and 30% design and increased percentage of design, the more information you have about the cost of the project. And so right now we have a 50% contingency on the cost, which is, a big chunk of money. But as you go forward and, develop more detailed information, then you have better cost estimates. For the business plan, as far as, when do you provide a business plan? Executive Director Preston mentioned that something, it's a living document. It can be updated every so many years in order to increase the information in there to better represent more recent information. Did I answer all of your questions? I'm not sure I got them all. Okay, thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner Brown. Chair recognizes Commissioner Cohen.
Thank you, Chair. I just wanted to clarify. I mean, we've heard this notion a couple of times that maybe a TIG-AM trolley type alternative might be preferred. If we were even going to contemplate that, would not the ridership numbers need to be reevaluated? I mean, essentially there would be less, a very substantially different level of service. So, you know, the notion that we're just going to cut the cost in half because now we're doing a trolley, I mean, would we not also need to consider the impacts on ridership?
I have not, part of the alternatives analysis was not to look specifically at the TIG-M model. So I don't really feel like I have an answer to you for that as far as how it would impact ridership. Do you have any sense of ridership?
The TIG-M vehicle is essentially the light rail vehicle that was contemplated in our study. So we did look at a system similar to a TIG-M vehicle running on our line. And the cost estimates we have are significantly higher than the cost estimates that TIG-M provided us. TIG-M provided us a proposal to do a public-private partnership, and their cost estimates were only based on pretty much the rail up. It didn't consider the infrastructure below the railing, the culverts, the bridges, significant other costs that would increase the overall cost of the project. I wouldn't say that the TIG-M model was not considered. I think it was just their governance model of doing a public-private partnership was not. At this particular time, we think that that's way too early. It's something that could certainly be discussed if this project was to move forward towards the environmental phase. And then you could develop a different business plan based on a public-private partnership if that's the direction the commission would like to go.
Thank you. Just a couple additional questions. The notion of a hydrogen train was mentioned. I mean, is that technology in place anywhere in the country today?
TIG-M is, I know that their vehicles are being used in Dubai, which is obviously not in this country, but they've also entered into a contract with the city of Riverside to potentially provide their vehicles for use there. Even though it's hydrogen cell, it's hydrogen electric. So that's why, we didn't specify the exact vehicle type. You know, it could just be traditionally generated electric, or it could be hydrogen cell electric. Those are the types of decisions that you don't need to make at this particular time. You could do, your vehicle selection after the environmental phase and choose one of many different types of vehicles.
Thank you. One last question. I believe Supervisor Caput, asked about whether other systems like this were in place today, and San Bernardino County was referenced. I would like to point out that is a county of 2 million people, and I'm curious, in our business analysis or our business study, if we're looking at, the total serviceable area and comparable systems. Has there been a successful passenger or light rail implementation for a population of our size, 275,000 people in this county?
Mr. Gubbins has his hands up.
Yeah, thank you. As Commissioner, I just wanted to weigh in here. And as I've mentioned before, or as I believe Ginger mentioned, I do have Kyle Gradinger from the Caltrans rail statewide, and he has some knowledge that I think he could share with us on this exact point. So Kyle, could you maybe answer that?
Yes, thank you, Tim, and through the chair. In response to the question about hydrogen, I just wanted to add that there are actual examples in the state of California of a hydrogen fuel cell light rail or a multiple unit vehicle that is in production at the moment. The Caltrans has funded a project with the San Bernardino County Transportation Authority to develop a hydrogen fuel cell light rail vehicle. And we are also in the process right now of looking at two other acquisitions And this concept is based on a product that has been operating in Europe on a demonstration basis for 2 years now. And the demonstration has resulted in at least three different agencies across Europe acquiring more than 50 of these vehicles. So just to sum it up, the concept of a hydrogen fuel cell vehicle, which is an electric quiet vehicle, is very much a reality internationally, but also specifically in California. And as a state, we are supporting that that technology development.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Just one other response to Commissioner Koenig's question. There is a table in the Appendix B in the back that provides examples of other transit in other communities throughout the U.S. as a and it gives you a sense for how they compare to a Santa Cruz County system.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Scipio, I think you had your hand up. Kyle, did you?
Oh, I apologize. That was in response to the previous question. I'll take my hand down.
Okay. That's quite fine.
Thank you, Chair.
Commissioner Myers, I see you had your hand up for a question.
Yeah, just one last question. I'm sorry. This is great conversation. I'm curious about, I did notice that there was a list of the comments in the packet today with regards to the various comments that have come in on the TCA report. I'm just curious if there's a way, is there a response, kind of a response to comments planned as part of finalizing the report? Just to be able to, again, put as much information out there to the public as possible. So I'm just curious about whether or not that will be finalized as the report is finalized as well. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner.
I can take that question. So part of the stakeholder, the primary stakeholder engagement was from November 6th to November 27th. Through the open house, as well as soliciting comments through email. And we took that information and considered all of the survey information as well as the email comments in order to revise the draft report to the final draft report. And you'll see in, I believe it's chapter 5 that talks about milestone 3 that shows how the report, it gives a summary for how the report was revised based on the comments received. We also have, we work as a staff to provide frequently asked questions. You know, we really work hard with trying to provide the information to our community as best we can. Obviously, this is a project that's passionate to many of our community members, and we can't always respond to every single question that we get, but our process has been to develop frequently asked questions. And as we get comments in, to go through those and pick out the ones that we're really going to provide that answers to our community's questions. And so we've been doing that even past the deadline of November 27th.
Okay. So we can find some of that, then we'll kind of point the public to some of those resources to be able to kind of tease out. Sounds like, okay. Great. Thank you very much.
Commissioner Rotkins, do you have a question on the study?
I just want to, on the public record, I was not advocating for the TIGM system. I just used it as an example of technology that might or might not be cheaper. And I just want that really clear. I mean, I don't have a particular axe to grind on that particular system. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner.
Can we hear from the public?
Is there any other commissioners that have questions? CNN? I have one question. My question in regards to the EIR that has to be performed, is this going to be performed before the business plan, or is it going to be in conjunction with the business plan?
There's been no direction from commission to staff to develop the environmental impact report for this. As part of the business plan, we would lay out when that environmental impact report would have to be completed in order to implement the project.
Because from my understanding, that's part of the strikeout, right? Or did I misread that or misinterpret that?
There was a revision in the resolution in order to clarify that, that as part of signing this resolution, you were not giving agreement to start an environmental impact report. Okay. That it was just stating that environmental impact report would potentially be needed to follow federal and state guidelines prior to any implementation. So it really was for clarification that
it wasn't for the business plan. Thanks. That's all the questions I have. I'm going to go ahead and take this and open this up to the public now for any public questions or comments. I will grant you 2 minutes, and Yesenia Parra will identify who's going to be speaking.
Okay, first is Doug, and after Doug will be Deb Molina.
Okay, Chair recognizes Doug.
Are you there? Hi, this is Doug Schenk. I appreciate being allowed to speak. I would ask the commission to stop with the impossible dream of installing light rail along the rail corridor in Santa Cruz. Have each of you commissioners seen how narrow the right-of-way is and how impossible it'll be to have a multi-purpose trail and a light rail corridor in that area? Have you also looked at the studies to see how expensive it's going to be to re-engineer all the bridges, all the right-of-way to do this? Have you seen how little Santa Clara County actually uses its light rail system and what a joke it is to the residents of Santa Clara County? Have you talked to the neighbors along the right-of-way to see how crazy and impossible it's going to be to run light rail trains multiple times an hour past their backyards? Just go ask Palo Alto residents how they like Caltrain. Are you guys crazy? And if you think that this won't be a part of how you're evaluated next ballot time as to whether or not you're speaking with the public's interest in mind, don't deceive yourselves. The only reason rail works is because of uninterrupted right-of-ways, heavy rail, and constraints on parking. Think of San Francisco or New York. Don't think of Santa Cruz or Santa Clara County. Electric bikes are the commute future in sunny Santa Cruz. Plan for the future, don't fantasize about the past. I appreciate you listening to my comments.
Thank you, Doug, for your time and your comments.
Deb Molina.
Debbie Molina.
Yes. Hi. Can you hear me?
Yes. You have 2 minutes.
Yes. I wanted to just address the comment that you've had numerous public input on all your surveys. I've taken the surveys for years, and I have never once seen trail only as an option. It was always, I always had to write it in as an other. So to pretend that it's anything that you're offering as a true option is not true. You've got ongoing expensive consultants, continue to cost us tax dollars money. You're getting us no closer to a true community decision. The two referendums on this issue that we have voted on, the measure in Capitola and electing Manu Koenig, points to what this community really wants. Mr. Rodkin and others who voted yay an hour ago, who voted down a discussion on having a trail only on the railroad corridor based on, quote, staff not having enough time to investigate, unquote, you have spent years, as well as loads of our tax dollars, not looking at the option of having a trail and ignoring the strong community support for a trail only. It's really frustrating to watch the process of you not even discussing it. Ms. Steiker, you titled your report Locally Preferred Alternative. I think it needs to be renamed Your Preferred Plan. When you actually ask the community by putting it to a vote, then we'll see what the true preferred alternative is. And I know the community wants a trail only. Let's see. Ms. Myers, you talked about the Metro bus getting more money, but other communities that have added rail transit have seen their bus budgets.
Thank you, Mrs. Molina. Thank you for your comments. You. We appreciate it.
Nick Adams and then Casey Kirkhart.
Chair recognizes Nick Adams.
Thank you for calling me.
Go ahead, Nick, you have 2 minutes.
Yes, thank you. I ask that the commission approve the TCAA and move forward with the business plan, but be sure to include an affordable light option that we can implement soon. The technology exists today, like a battery electric streetcar or trolley built in California and scheduled to provide a demonstration later this year. I hope the commissioner will suggest a friendly amendment to include a streetcar trolley system as an alternative. I ask you please to show the video. Please show the video. Thank you.
Thank you, sir, for your comments. We have next
Casey Kirkhart and then Rebecca Downing.
Chair recognizes Casey.
He might or she may have dropped off. I don't see her name. So Rebecca Downing and then Benjamin Levine.
Chair recognizes Rebecca.
Yes, good morning. Can you hear me?
Yes.
We all want a robust transportation network that serves the maximum number of residents in a sustainable, equitable way. But rail transit doesn't accomplish this. It will not run after 9 p.m. It won't stop within walking distance of our major employers, downtown Santa Cruz, UCSC, or Cabrillo College, or a potentially redeveloped Capitola Mall. Riders will need to drive if there's adequate parking at the station, or ride the bus to a station before boarding a train, and then take a bus for the last part of the trip. It doesn't even remove enough drivers from the daily commute to ease traffic. You know, views from passenger rail, which I love riding, along the coast do sound lovely, but the recent storm eroded the rail bed and undermined the tracks at Manresa Beach. So coastal erosion is only going to increase with climate change. So it just doesn't seem like a smart place to put this type of transit. Now, the TCAA study that includes BRT coordinating with Metro Santa Cruz, you know, Metro already reaches all the major employers and colleges. The BRT integrates future bus on shoulder, Highway 1 routes, and uses current roads to get all the travelers to and from destinations more quickly than the train. It also incorporates the values of sustainable Santa Cruz, which I did not see mentioned in the study, the City of Santa Cruz's active transportation plan, and the AMBAG 2040 Metropolitan Transit Plan. Currently, Metro stops in more places more often and better serves the needs of South County commuters because it goes where we need to go at a price we can afford. So I think BRT is the best option for Santa Cruz County. My last request is that Carrie Pico's slides be put in the minutes. Thank you.
And your comments.
Benjamin Levine and then Timothy Randazzo.
Chair recognizes Benjamin Rondine.
Hello, commissioners. My name is Benji Levine, and I am a Santa Cruz resident in the King Street neighborhood. I support the rail as a locally preferred transit option on the rail corridor because the train is an investment in our future, an investment in sustainable transit and the sustainable development that relies on it. If coastal towns like Santa Cruz are not part of the solution, then by the time I grow up, much of this town that I love will be part of the past. Westcliff will erode away, our beaches will sink, and many communities will flood regularly. It is time to act now. Thank you, commissioners.
Thank you, Benjamin, for your comments.
Timothy Randazzo and then Deborah Comer.
Chair recognizes Timothy Randazzo. Timothy, you there?
All right, Deborah.
Deborah.
Deborah Comer and then Lee Silvergate.
Chair recognizes Deborah Colbert.
Comer.
Comer. Comer.
You're on mute, Ms. Colmar.
Are you there, Ms. Palmer? You need to unmute yourself.
Am I new?
Okay, now you go ahead. You got 2 minutes.
I just want to say that I would support that the board accept the TCAA and do the business plan, and that the scope be expanded to include light, fast streetcar service that could be more appropriate and affordable for the public. I also would like to add that the trail only concept that I've heard spoken of just reflects such a privileged attitude toward the needs of the population of Santa Cruz County, especially South County. Is there some sort of plan to buy electric bikes for everybody to take that trip from the Watsonville to Santa Cruz? I doubt it, very seriously. We need public transit options on the trail, and whether it's rail, whether it's a streetcar service, whatever it is, it's what we need. And I do support the rail and trail effort. Thank you.
Thank you, Mrs. Kohler, for your comments. Next.
Lee Silvergate and then Daniel Harper.
Chair recognizes Lee.
Hi, can you hear me?
Yes, you're on, Lee Silvergate.
Great, thank you. My name is Lee Silvergate. I am a Santa Cruz native of the West Side, and I recently moved back after graduating from college. And today I'm voicing support for passenger rail along the corridor. One of the main reasons that I am supporting rail over the proposed bus service alternative is because it's going to be able to carry far more bikes and be able to integrate more effectively with our growing bike lane system. Electric passenger rail coupled with bikes for that last mile of ridership is the best way for us to be able to meet our sustainability and transit needs, and also just make our community a safer place for pedestrians and riders, and just a more enjoyable place to live and navigate on a daily basis. Growing up here, I've really seen firsthand how quickly our community is growing. I think we can all agree upon that. And investing in public transit really is not optional. And public transit boosts local economies. So this is something we should all be really eager to do. And all of our transportation experts, after extensive review, have agreed that passenger rail is the best option for us. This is a multi-generational project. It's going to benefit our community, not just for the next 10 or 20 years, but for the next 100. It doesn't make any sense for us to be talking about replacing already existing usable infrastructure, especially when doing so could disqualify us from state funding for the project. And especially when doing so will surely delay both trail construction and any transit implementation. The fastest way for us to get both a trail and transit is to approve rail as the locally preferred alternative. Please vote in favor of the passenger rail today, and thank you for your time.
Thank you, Mr. Silvergate, for your comments.
Daniel Harper, then Susan Salt.
Commissioner recognizes Daniel Harper.
Hi, everybody. I hope you're having a great day, morning. My name is Daniel Harper, and I'm a Santa Cruz resident. I prefer the rail trail as the locally preferred transit option on the rail corridor. The rail provides a long-term solution to the county's transportation issues and will help create a more sustainable and equitable Santa Cruz County. I think by including Watsonville in the corridor, it promotes environmental justice because they've been left out of infrastructure. And with a new administration in Washington, there will be more federal grant money available to build the rail. That's kind of my take on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Harper, for your comments.
It looks like Susan is no longer on the call. So Benjamin, Judy.
Yeah, Judy, hey,
what do we have?
We have Judy Gittleson.
Chair recognizes Judy Gittleson. You have 2 minutes.
Hi, I'm Judy Gittleson, a Watsonville resident. Yes, passenger rail for Santa Cruz County. A plea, a wish, a hope, and a prayer, the best we could do for the county and air is to build and install a new rail right here. It's gorgeous, it's open, the reasons are clear. Create healthy people, community, friends. The list is so long, it never ends. A route is all planned, most are on board. The talents of many we need not hoard. Develop and implement, execute, do, help pave the way, cement a future improved. Our county, our country, our citizens, yes. The economy booms, cars transport less. The coast will thank you, the whole world will too. To tour our coast car-free, what a hullabaloo. A seashore vacation will now be a breeze. Travel in style, oh, if you please. There's much to be done, some terribly hard. Politics, towns, earth, and those cars. The people, their choices, we're here on the coast. Our ocean's amazing, remarkable, we boast. Let's make this reality without a big fuss. A quiet accomplishment, the world watches us. With a good hand from you, what we can get done will add up the numbers greater than some. Let the sun shine and let the earth move. Let's better the planet, yeah, get in the groove. A loud thanks for your ear. Now please lend your words and make sure they're solid and make sure they're heard. Get ladies and men across this great land, picking up shovels and lending a hand. Type on computers, text on their phones, encourage us all, now hurry and soon. Let's reach for the stars and look to the sea, smell the sweet air while it's still fresh and it's free. Yes, passenger rail, hop on this train.
Thank you for your comments and thank you.
You're welcome.
Next.
Rebecca Rockman and then Dan Dion. Rockham, Rebecca Rockham.
Rebecca Rocca, chair recognizes you, you have 2 minutes.
Good morning, my name is Rebecca Rockham and I recently moved to Santa Cruz from Portland, Oregon, where I'm one remote class away from my master's degree in urban and regional planning. While in Portland, where transit options are plentiful and efficient, my husband and I regularly commuted by bike and public transit to our jobs downtown. As a passionately dedicated bus and light rail rider, I strongly urge the commission to please vote to approve the staff report and adopt rail as the locally approved alternative for the Santa Cruz County Transit Corridor. I feel this package could transform transportation in our county, adding eco-friendly and equitable commuting options for those who cannot or choose not to drive and park. As Mayor Myers noted, the TCAA report cites a $25 million price tag for rail service, and a closer look reveals that this cost includes increasing metro budget by $12 million. Almost half that budget is for bus service, not for rail. This increase could add 32% more metro bus service to our community. So the proposal before you is not just for rail service, but a complete transportation package that includes clean and electric rail service and a substantial increase in metro bus service, which all works together for our beloved car-free trail. Please don't miss this opportunity to update our transit infrastructure and prepare for a sustainable future. Please vote to approve the staff recommendation and adopt electric rail service as the locally preferred alternative for our corridor. Thank you for your time and careful consideration of this issue.
Thank you, Rebecca, for those comments.
Dan Dion and then Dave Riggs.
I want to make a comment here real quick before we start. I'm going to take just the last two comments from the public and I want to bring it back to the commission. I think I've allowed enough comment from the public. And we need to move forward. So these will be the last two comments that I will receive from the public.
Mr. Chair, if I may, we should get confirmation from Yesenia that there are not others who haven't spoken yet. If the commission is going to change the practice, your earlier determination was to take all public comments that had not been heard before. And so I'd recommend we stay with that.
Okay, how many more do we have, Yesenia? Thank you for that correction.
We have quite a bit more. I haven't counted them, but we do have quite a bit of hands up.
Nice try, Aurelio, but apparently it won't work.
Well, okay, as long as they haven't spoken, I guess at this point, what I'm gonna do now, since we have so many, I'm gonna reduce it to a 1 minute. Public and just to allow everybody a time frame because I know there's commissioners that most likely would have to go to attend other meetings, especially county supervisors or some folks that may have to go back to their employment. And I do want to give everybody an opportunity. So let's go ahead and we'll proceed and we're just going to reduce it down now to 1 minute.
Okay, Dan Dion and then Dave Riggs.
Good morning. I will help you out with your 1 minute limit.
I vote that we go forward with the staff recommendation. And I want to add that the trail we've already funded and have begun building is plenty wide. We absolutely, at this point in the foreseeable future, do not need a wider trail. It's underutilized as it is. Building it from point to point where people can actually use it to commute on their bikes is a priority. Secondarily, I think we need rail on our rail corridor. Thank you.
Thank you. Next.
Dave Ricks, then Veronica Elsie.
Chair recognizes Dave Ricks.
Yes, my name's Dave Riggs. I'm a Santa Cruz County resident. Look, I think we have a glaringly obvious problem, and that is that Highway 1 from Santa Cruz to La Selva Beach is a parking lot every day and every morning and every afternoon. And I think this is an economic problem, an environmental problem, and frankly, a social justice problem. The longer we delay in addressing this issue, the more expensive it becomes. And I think we need to not only approve the recommendation to build an efficient, modern passenger rail service between Santa Cruz and Watsonville, but we should go forward with that with focus and a high level of urgency to get it done.
Thank you for your comments.
Veronica Elsie, then Emily Trexel.
The chair recognizes Veronica Elsie. In 1 minute.
Okay, hi, good morning. I'm Veronica Elsie, a Santa Cruz resident who happens to be blind. I can assure you I will not be riding an electric bicycle to Watsonville. I want to point out that there will be a cost savings from paratransit because more people who use wheelchairs can hop on a rail, go somewhere. Right now, our medical clinics are expanding, and frankly, there are appointments that I do not keep because it can take me up to 2 hours each way to get out to Capitola and back. So I support the shortened transit times. I support being able to hop on a train and walk in Watsonville because there's a trail. So please consider everyone in the population and how badly we need rail because this town is still growing. Thank you.
Thank you, Elsie, for your comments.
Emily Trexel, then Nick Masotti.
Chair recognizes
Emily.
Emily.
Hi there. So the first thing I wanted to say is thank you. The next, I don't think anybody's mentioned the COVID situation. So, I mean, the reality is our future is changing. I think it's irresponsible to approve this now. When you're talking about places like New York that were hit so hard because they're densely populated and they ride, right? And so they're close together. So you're talking about a future. This is not the end of something like COVID. So the future of people riding in densely packed trains is unlikely. I think that we also haven't considered the cost of lawsuits that rail brings, deaths, injuries. That could be millions in lawsuits later. You know the county will be sued for that situation at some point. To minimize that, it requires fencing and blocking access along our gorgeous beaches, which is why we live here. I think that it doesn't really address the needs of commuters. You're talking about someplace like even La Selva that won't even have except for seasonal access. So this isn't really as much for our local people as it is for tourists. It doesn't go to Scotts Valley, where people from South County go to pick up their transit buses over to, let's say, the tech industry. It just doesn't make sense.
All right, Nick Masotti, then Carl Kaplan. Nick?
Nick. Chair recognizes Nick.
Hi, everyone. My name is Nick. I live in the West Side and I support the rail as a locally preferred alternative for transit on the rail corridor. With the threat of climate change looming, we're a county, we need to go big on transit to get more people out of the gas guzzling cars and into clean electric trains. Building passenger rail and trail will create a more walkable and sustainable city and will cement Santa Cruz County as a leader in climate change and help usher in, us into a better future. And with the new administration in Washington, federal money will be available to build the rail. So that will be a great help and asset to us. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Nick, for those comments.
Carl Kaplan and then Don Lauritsen.
Chair recognizes Carl Kaplan for 1 minute.
My name is actually Lawrence Kaplan. My wife and I live in Watsonville.
I have a long history in the county, including a politics class with Professor Rotkin at UCSC in 1973. For the last 20 years, I've worked as a lawyer and a finance executive at a multinational company, supervising five-year plans every year. Here, I've heard serious, well-intentioned people discuss their obligation to plan 20, 30, or even 100 years out. This approach is ultimately a mistake. We are in a world of rapid change, and as such, we should rely on shorter term, more targeted, more reliable to achieve goals. In particular, looking at the county in subparts, as transportation obstacles differ significantly from north to south. Seriously consider reinstituting select bus service, perhaps electric or hydrogen powered. That could make a real difference faster and at a much lower price. In addition, and in summary, I do not see any real likelihood that all the voters of this county will ultimately support the enormous cost of the rail project. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Kaplan, for your comments.
We have Don Lauritsen and then Tom Hade.
Don Lauritsen, you're recognized.
Can you hear me?
Yes.
Go ahead. Thank you for your time today. I live in East Santa Cruz. I've been an county resident for 40 years. I'm a member of FORT and support both the rail and trail. Urge you to vote for a rail as a locally preferred alternative to avoid delays in construction of the adjacent trail for the following reasons. The current trail design assumes that the tracks will remain in place. Changes to the plan will just delay the trail construction because new design would have to be made and approved all over again. This happened with the Rana Gulch Trail, which is now being enjoyed and many wondering why it took so long in the first place. Any change to the plan will trigger new environmental review and thus more delays. Segments of the trail are currently under construction and design, ready to build, and changing the plan would seriously delay the progress. The trail will be much more useful if it's adjacent to the rail service because people can ride much further.
Thank you.
They can walk or bike. Thank you. Thank you
for your comments.
Tom Haith and David Van Brink.
You recognize Don? Is that Don?
Tom.
Okay, so I wasn't unmuted when it started. So
go ahead, you have a minute.
You can start the clock over. Okay, so I had 2 minutes ready to go here, but now I'll do a minute. So I live in a senior mobile home park here in Live Oak area. We have 120 units, approximately 220 residents, and I'm on the board of directors. I took a poll of what people want in our park, whether a train or just a trail or both. And there's my results. 100% said, no, we do not want a train. 20% said we would take a trail with the train. And then the others were just, everybody really wanted the trail because none of them said they would use the train to go anywhere. It's not to shop, not to go, we just wouldn't use it as a senior. What we do want is a bus system, small buses that run around town, we can get around, come to our park, get around downtown, etc. We will never use a train.
Thank you, Mr. Hay, for your comment.
I'd like it put to a public vote.
Thank you for your comment, Tom.
Okay, we have David Van Brink and then Elaine Ralphs.
Chair recognizes David Van Brink.
Van Brink.
Good afternoon. A quick note. Also, Nick Adams had previously requested 1 minute of his time for the Costa Futura video. I want to speak in favor of approving the TCAA and the locally preferred alternative of electric rail transit. The experts all support this, the main cities and all environmental groups, including the Coastal Commission and the science support this. I know from my involvement with Friends of the Rail and Trail that there is definitely wide community support for this. Opponents are, of course, rather more shouty, but not necessarily more numerous. Last month, Rod Duradin Sr., who certainly has some insight on all this, suggested if we have a project shovel ready, the money will be there. There's always fiscal uncertainty, but I hope that we plan forward in such a way that when funding is available, we'll be in line for our share. Thanks for all you do.
Thank you for your comments, Mr. Van Brink.
We have Elaine Ralphs and then Gary Jameson. Elaine?
Elaine, Chair recognizes Elaine. 1 minute.
Mute. Can you hear me?
Yes.
Thank you. Thank you for all your efforts, and I'm in support of the passenger rail. So thank you very much for continuing to pursue that. Thank you.
Thank you for your comments, Elaine.
Gary Jameson and then Jack Brown.
Hi, commissioners.
Great. Sorry about that.
Yeah, it's Gray Jameson.
Great.
Thank you. Yeah, I hope that at least some of you would remember me. I've spoken at many meetings before. I've been a passionate transit advocate since high school. I am now in my second year at Cabrillo College. I live in District 2 here in Live Oak, and I urge you all to support and vote for approving the TCAA today to approve rail transit for our county. It is one of the most important decisions you will ever make as part of this board. And I urge you to vote for it. It is so important. And like we've seen with so many things recently, the wildfires and everything, how much our climate is changing. And we need to move quickly as possible to bring our greenhouse gas emissions down. And this is the best way to do it. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Jameson, for your comments.
Jack Brown, then Lanai.
Chair recognizes Mr. Jack Brown.
Hi, thank you for having me. I'm Jack Brown from Aptos. I wish to show that you please reject the TCAA. A plan that takes 25 years for climate action is not going to help climate action. And the degree in which it can help, only taking 3,500 cars out of 117,000 that are currently going, is not going to make a dent in what we need to do. Since I've got limited time, I just really wanted to focus on the TIG-M solution here. There was a lot of circling of the drain and the answers on the experience. This company has zero experience in commuter rail. They have a mall ride at the Grove in LA where they have their 10 years of experience and millions of hours, supposedly. The Dubai project that was noted has been shelved. It's a static display that's been on for 5 years. Please let's not go down the Theranos route and let's get back to a trail solution with bus. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Brown, for your comments.
Lanai, then Lisa Smith. Lanai, sorry about that.
Chair recognizes.
Hi, I'm sorry, it's funky to unmute. My name's Lonnie Faulkner and I support rail and trail. I'm a local Santa Cruz resident for over 25 years and I'm a Live Oak resident. I just want to say that I'm hoping that we can get on task with places like Europe and China and Japan. I'm also an avid cyclist and runner. I definitely support trail. A rail-only consideration, I think, is very limited in thought and doesn't consider economically challenged members of our community, including students who need to commute to South County and those who are challenged economically. I'm also in the medical professions. Travel right now, even during COVID, is bumper to bumper on Highway 1 North and South. I know as a past commuter, I would really value trail as well as rail. Both have value for those of us who run and bike and want to get to South County for work and other needs. Let's see.
Thank you for your comments, Ms. Lenny.
Okay, thank you.
Okay, we have Lisa Smith, then Gregory Becker.
Greg, Chair recognizes.
Lisa Smith.
Lisa Smith.
Hi, I have been a District 1 local for over 30 years. And what I'm finding highly unusual is that you guys are trying to make a decision of this kind with a one meeting alternate from Metro when the actual alternate will be seated in the next meeting. It is also inequitable when this change leads to the underrepresentation of Mid-County, where I live, in this decision where it has two representatives on the RTC today and the city of Santa Cruz has four, despite Mid-County having a larger population. I would request that this decision is delayed to the next meeting when the rightful representation of our county is in place. I also find it quite ironic that the commissioner suggests that he wants to vote on the preferred alternative today suggests that the preferred alternative is not what he actually wants.
Thank you, Lisa, for your comments.
If this is the case, what are we voting on today?
Thank you for your comments.
We have Gregory Becker, then Linda Wilcherson.
Chair recognizes
Gregory.
Gregory Becker.
I'm just calling to talk about the proposed high-level business plan. I was reading the transcript from the May 13th, 2019 meeting where Mr. Preston appeared before the California Transportation Commission and promised that he would have a high level, or at least a business plan, by January 2000. I thought that would be great. And the California Transportation Commission agreed to help develop this high level business plan, and it still hasn't arrived. And now you're being asked to support something that you have zero information on the actual cost or the actual business plan. No business would even begin operating without at least having a purpose, a high-level business plan. Thank you. That's all I have to say.
Thank you, Mr. Becker, for your comments.
Linda Wilcherson, then Charlie Wilcox.
Chair recognizes Linda Wilcherson. Sorry about that.
Good morning. My name is Linda Wilcherson. I was executive director of the RTC from 1985 to 2005. I support the staff recommendation today. We need to have more and cleaner travel options now along our primary travel corridor between Watsonville, Mid County, and Santa Cruz, where we have population densities that are equivalent to the San Francisco Bay Area. Our county purchased this rail line explicitly to use for public transportation and for a public trail. This intent has been reaffirmed by the RTC time and time again, and is enthusiastically supported by a wide range of state and local agencies and organizations, including the California Coastal Commission and Caltrans. Thank you for all your listening, commissioners, and for your careful deliberations on these kinds of complicated decisions, because we rely on you, our elected and appointed representatives, to fully consider the highest public good into the future.
Thank you for
as you make comments. These decisions on our behalf.
Thank you for your comments.
Carly Wilcox, then Timothy Randazzo.
Chair recognizes Carly Wilcox.
Carly?
1 minute.
Hi, thank you. I'll keep it short and sweet. I feel like the conversation has not included all of the appropriate alternatives, the directions going towards BRT, and understanding what can be done in a reasonable time frame, and in, frankly, my lifetime would be welcomed by me particularly. I really feel like the economic viability has not been well considered. And my earlier comment regarding buying electric bikes for everyone, I've actually sat and done the math. I encourage the staff and the commissioners to do the math. That could be done. A BRT solution combined with the last mile solution for folks with disabilities and folks who have other kinds of disadvantages would actually be more feasible. Thank you for your time. Do the right thing.
Thank you, Mr. Wilcox, for your comments.
Timothy Randazzo, then Trank Praxel.
Timothy Randazzo, you're recognized by the chair. You have 1 minute. Is he unmuted? Is he there? Can we?
Go ahead.
You have 1 minute.
Thank you, commissioners, for the acknowledgement. My name is Timothy Patrick Randazzo, and I come before you in support of the electric passenger train option along the rail trail. This investment will serve as an equitable support resource for our communities and as a crutch for our planet. As climate pollution rises, it's important than ever for state and local leaders to take action and address greenhouse gas emissions, and to set a precedent for aspiring young leaders to follow. Developing a modern clean transportation system by expanding access to electric public transit will save lives, human and non-human, create new jobs, stimulate long-run economic gain, and improve operational efficiency in many sectors as our workers will be able to travel faster through transit and decrease traffic congestion. That's why there's public support for this altruistic action, and we look forward to working with you to sustain economic opportunities with equity in mind to safeguard a future for our families. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Redondo, for your comments.
Trent Praxel.
Trent? Praxel? You're recognized by chair.
Thank you. I did have to find the unmute button. I just want to point out, first of all, I want to support the staff recommendation in support of the rail option. And I just want to point out a couple of points that have not been touched on much by other speakers. One is that this rail corridor is our last cross-county corridor, possible transportation corridor in our county. And I think it would be a shame not use it for a wider range of public transportation options. As one of your staff members said just a while ago in this discussion, in this meeting, that there is, our county population is going to increase, but our road structure is not going to increase over the years. And we need to hang on to as many non-road based options as we can in looking forward into the future. So thank you very much.
Thank you, Mrs. Praxel, for your comments.
Commissioner Gonzalez, I have no other hands up that did not speak last month. I do see two people that have their hands up. However, they are on the list as having spoken last month.
Okay, well, thank you. So, okay, not seeing any more new public speakers, I'm gonna go ahead and move this on and bring it back to the commission. I am gonna ask the commissioners to make comments only and to refrain for 2 minutes to your comments. So if you could raise your hands and then I could proceed.
Just a point of order. Is there any reason we can't make motions at this time?
Yeah, that's. No, I'm as a chair, first I'm taking the comments.
Point of order, typically comments are made after a motion is on the floor. That is actually in accordance with Robert's rules and parliamentary procedure.
The chair has the option of doing whichever way he wants to do it.
So really quickly, any
well, comments? I'm prepared to make a motion, I'm prepared to move staff recommendation.
But see no comments. Hang on. See no comments from the commission. The commissioner recognizes Eduardo Montesino.
Yeah, like I said, I'm ready to start the conversation and move staff recommendation. Hopefully I can get a second with that.
So that's a motion on the table?
Excuse me, Chair, you just clarified that you would not be taking motions at this time.
I did, and I went down and I asked if anybody had any comments, and I didn't see no commissioners doing any comments or raising their hands. And so proceeded
forward. Commissioner Mulhern and Commissioner Johnson raising their hands. Commissioner Mulhern and Johnson, Jenny Johnson.
You have 2 minutes for comments. Mulhern, go ahead.
Thank you, I guess. I guess what I've derived from all these various studies that we've been through is that transit on the corridor is incredibly expensive. I think that that we've factored in some optional funding sources that we may be able to tap over the next 25 years to reach the $500 million that it's going to take to build this. I don't dispute that that money is available for building, but there isn't any money, or there certainly isn't enough money for operations and maintenance. So prior to approving the staff recommendations, I'm hoping that we could insert some language into the resolution that would allow us to proceed, but only after identifying some mechanism for making up this funding gap. I believe it's 46% funding gap for operations and maintenance. The report itself says that it would most likely have to be a tax measure. So I'm hoping that we could add a whereas into the resolution that says following the environmental phase. So we addressed that, you mentioned that, Chair. The new draft of the resolution. So following the environmental phase and prior to implementing the preferred alternative, a tax measure supporting rail transit shall be passed. And by my calculations, we're short by $12 to $15 million a year to pay for this. There's no way that a transit system obviously can be implemented without addressing this funding shortfall first. I think that after an environmental phase, we'll have a better idea of what the actual costs of whatever technology we're going to choose are going to be. But I think before we proceed any further down after our environmental phase, we need to identify some source for this funding. So I would like that language inserted into the resolution, please.
Thank you, Patrick, for those comments. Commissioner Beltran, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you very much, Chair. I just like to go back to some public comment that was made when Ed Bortoff was chair, and that was by Steve Woodhouse. And he detailed that he was very instrumental in, he's a county council, and he was living in Sonoma at the time. He was very instrumental in getting the SMART proposal on the ballot. He worked very hard to make sure that that passed. And his comments to this board was that we do not have the economic base in this county to support a rail system. He was blunt, absolutely blunt. I cannot support approving the staff recommendation without a clear, detailed analysis of what the costs are. To our public, we are stewards of the public dollar. We cannot, I believe, at least for me personally, in good conscience, vote for something when that is not clearly understood from a financial standpoint. Because it's the financial standpoint, if it's voted one way or the other, has repercussions. When we vote to do something, we also vote not to do something. The cost for this rail, as I understand it right now, and I would like more clarity because that's why I want the business plan, but the cost for this rail at this time, as I understand it, will mean a great load on this community that, as Steve Woodhouse talked about, can't afford extra projects. So the opportunity cost to do all sorts of other things that we clearly know that we need to do will not be met.
Thank you.
I'm not finished.
I'm giving everybody 2 minutes.
Okay, well, thank you. You need to consider the opportunity cost, not only for tax purposes, but also for the RTC staff, what they could be working on to solve transportation issues. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner, for your comments. Commissioner Kappa, you have 2 minutes for your comments.
Okay. Yeah, thank you. I don't know. Do we have a motion and the second is?
You have 2 minutes for comments, Commissioner Caput.
We're still commenting. I would go along with Eduardo's motion and also include the language of Patrick Mulhern. And if that's okay with Eduardo, if you were the one who wants to make
we'll get back to that.
That's my only comment. Think about it.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Brown, Chair recognizes Commissioner Brown.
Thank you. Yeah, I just wanted to make a comment. I think my position has been clear as we move through this process, and I do want to move forward with the recommendation from staff, although I think there may be some changes that may come forward. With respect to Commissioner Mulhern's amendment or addition, I really don't feel comfortable including something like that right now. It appears to me that that would, not necessarily tie us legally, but it would cause us to be making a decision contingent upon a sales tax measure. And we don't even know what a plan, and we don't even have a project. So I think that doing that, while we know that that's a likely potential funding source, it seems very premature to me to include that as a contingency.
I'm sorry, just to clarify, I didn't say sales tax, just a tax measure, whatever tax measure that may be.
Okay, a local tax measure. Yeah.
A local tax measure, whatever that form it takes.
Thank you. Commissioner Cohen, you have 2 minutes to comment.
Thank you. I would move to amend the staff recommendation.
We're only taking
not a motion on the floor.
Minutes.
Excuse me. I believe that before when there was comments, the chair moved directly to taking a motion. Why could I not move an amendment at this time?
There is no motion,
on the floor.
Oh, I thought Eduardo's motion was on the floor.
No, yeah. It's not.
No, we're open to comments. Okay. You have a minute and a half left. No comment.
If I'm just commenting now, I would just point out, you know, Ms. Dikar asked me to look at the table that shows comparable systems, comparable rail systems. When you do that and you look at SMART, you can see that there's about 2,400 boardings per day. That is for a population area that is three times the size of our county. I think it's interesting that some of the speakers chose to say we need rail because if our county's growing, our county would have to grow three times, and we can see a real life project that's been implemented has merely one third of the projected ridership that we're projecting for our system. So it seems to me that the projected ridership that's being proposed here is radically overestimated. I believe that's consistently the case when we look at systems that have been implemented across the country. That's my comment.
Thank you, Commissioner Cohen, for your comments. Is there any other commissioner that'd like to make a comment?
Yes.
Commissioner Rodkins, you have 2 minutes.
Thank you. The question before us today is what's our locally preferred alternative? It's not a decision to begin pouring millions or billions of dollars into a particular system. And basically, it's what's become clear through the study, the TCAA bus on this corridor does not add anything to the transportation mobility of the county, nothing at all. We've done a study that showed that, and people said we didn't study the question of trail only. We did study that in our first proposal. There was, the idea was we'd have to put the public transit back on Highway 1 only. The situation in front of us today is bus on this corridor makes no sense. If you want to have public transit sometime now or in the future, you need to choose this option. And then, of course, not spend a lot of money on this until we know what exactly it is we want to build. But you have to preserve this option for people into the public. Tearing up the rails, deciding on trail only means they will never have decent public transit through this county. So the option of choice of that's before us, does a bus system make sense? No. It adds nothing in terms of time to getting anywhere. It wouldn't reduce the number of people riding on the highway. We have no positive impact. Rail is the only logical thing to choose right now. And I agree with the people that are saying, don't spend a lot of money until you know what you're spending it on. It's money you don't even know if you have. That makes total sense. You need to have a business plan, some idea of where the money would come from and what exactly you'd get in terms of like transit ridership when it made it happen. So let's make the decision today to keep rail as our option for the future, but not spend a lot of money on it till we know what exactly it is we're spending it on. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Commissioner Rutkins. Is there any other commissioner, fellow commissioner? Yeah.
Mr. Chair, it's Virginia Johnson. I'm sorry, maybe I'm not in your screen. I've been raising my hand.
I recognize you. You have 2 minutes.
Thank you so much. So Commissioner McPherson has supported doing the TCA study consistently because he knew we needed to fulfill our promise to the voters under Measure D to investigate and compare the transit options. We needed better answers, and now we have better answers. And this study is very valuable. And once again, he asked me to thank the staff and the consultants for producing it. But what we're looking at today is not a complete product. We need the business plan. I think I hear concurrence on that. And although the business plan brings forward prior cost estimates, it also lays out the steps that we're going to have to take in order to build passenger rail and make it a reality. And that's really an important transparency conversation with our community. It's a conversation we need to have. As Commissioner McPherson has said many times before, it is good public policy to reserve the options along that trail corridor. And I think that's also, I hear a lot of agreement on that. We need to bolster our current transit system. And he is a bolsterer of that. He's a member of Metro, and that's a very, very big priority. But it would be irresponsible for us to say this is our preferred alternative without understanding where we're going to pay for it and how what steps we have to take. So I can't vote today to approve this as a preferred alternative. I would prefer to wait until April 1st and we have that business plan. Our consultants have all the information they need to produce that business plan already. We've already paid for it. Let's get that and then we can actually understand better the financial impacts and the steps we're going to have to take. Thank you, Mr. Chair.
Thank you. An alternate resolution, Chair.
Hang on. Is any other fellow commissioners
Randy has his hand up.
Randy, Chair recognizes Randy Johnson.
Thank you, Chair. I did want to interject and question why there's a 2-minute limit on what should really be a contemplative, I think, process where commissioners respond to the myriad. I mean, we had like 50 people bring up 100 different points, and all of a sudden we're being rushed. Now, last meeting, we spent 6 hours at a meeting, and this is within, it's not even 12 o'clock yet. We haven't even spent 3 hours, and we essentially have one subject here. So I would ask you to rescind your, I guess it's an order, demand that, you know, commissioners back away from, that we have to, you know, do all of our thinking, our thoughts, our points within 2 minutes, because it's just so arbitrary. Why would we do that? That's a question to the chair.
Oh, sorry. You know, my feelings on this is that we've had enough time to comment throughout the whole studies that the staff has brought to us. If there's any more new revealing comments, I feel that you should be able to do them within the 2 minutes.
Well, how would you know that? Because you don't know what's new and what isn't.
Well, the study hasn't changed. So if you had any comments on the study, could have made them and had the opportunity to make them in the past.
Really?
But if you have any more new comments,
how do you know that?
Have less than 30 seconds.
So you're curtailing my comments because you think I should have, in some way have known about what's been said, what hasn't, not respond to the new comments that were made today, and just kind of fall under a 2-minute arbitrary sort of demand.
Point of order. Randy, you may be right, but what you have is the right to make a motion to overturn the chair's ruling here. That's otherwise we're going to spend money talking about procedure, but that's how you get past it if that's what you want to do.
Okay, point of order. I would like to make a motion that that as traditional, we're allowed to kind of we're not the public. We are the people assigned with the responsibility of being contemplative, bringing things in and making our points. You didn't make a 2-minute thing when people were asking questions. I really appreciate all the questions that Donna Myers posed, and she took 6-8 minutes to do so.
Okay. And you had the same right to do that also. I didn't negate on anybody's right to ask any questions and the amount of questions that they had.
Well, I would
do
ask.
Do you have a motion on the table?
Yeah, I would ask that you return to the traditional contemplative way of commissioners being allowed to speak without being fettered with a 2-minute limit.
I'll second that motion.
There's a motion and a second.
I think we should have discussion on this motion. Thank you very much, Chair.
Can I comment on the motion?
Go ahead, Andy. We'll open it up for comment.
My understanding of why you as the chair limited conversation to initial comments to 2 minutes is so that then there could be a motion put on the floor. And then once a motion was put on the floor to take action, then commissioners could comment on the action that was being proposed. I don't think that if I'm understanding that correctly, I don't think that unfairly restricts a commissioner's ability to comment on the issues. It just focuses it on the actions that the commission needs to take. So, you know, is my understanding correct?
What I wanted to do was allow you guys 2 minutes to comment, general comments on it. And then once the motion was brought onto the table, then we can open it to discussion. That's the procedure I wanted to take, because then that way we can discuss the motion that's on the table.
Can I make procedurally, since there's a motion on the floor, we should simply vote on it up or down. If it fails, then we'll see which way it goes. And with the understanding of what will happen if it fails is that we'll get a chance to talk after the motion. That's what's on the floor, I think.
Yeah. So can I have a roll call vote?
Commissioner Bertrand?
No.
Wait.
Commissioner Brown?
He's called it, Randy, I'm sorry.
No.
Commissioner Randy Johnson?
Right.
Commissioner Montesino? Commissioner Caput?
Let me read back to the exact motion. Who made the motion? Who made the second? What are we voting on?
Randy moved that we overrule the chair and have just be allowed to speak for as long as we like right now. The chair clarified that if we don't follow that procedure, they'll get a chance to make our comments after there's a motion on the floor. So the choice is, do you want to have a right to have open comments from all members right now? That's the motion on the floor.
All right.
I did not understand that motion, so I'm going to switch to aye. I rescind my vote to change to aye and support the resolution. I did not quite understand it. It should have been repeated to at least to help me understand. Thank you very much.
I'm voting no.
Commission Alternate Schifrin?
No.
Commission Alternate Mulhern?
No.
Commissioner Koenig?
No.
Commission Alternate Virginia Johnson?
No.
Commission Alternate Myers?
No.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
No.
Commissioner Rodkin?
No.
That motion failed.
So motion failed. So I want to wrap up with the commissioners and allow them the 2 minutes. So any commissioner that'd like to speak on this? Commissioner John Olinick?
Olinick, did I say that correct? All right. Thank you. My name's John Olinick. Our district director, Tim Govins, had to step out, so he asked me just to take a spot. And just wanted to mention from the Caltrans perspective that we support the locally preferred alternative. It has countywide benefits, the multimodal strategy for both the county and beyond. And also just as a point that this plan is consistent with the state rail plan, which envisions this corridor as part of the state network. And just as a side point, that also helps when it comes to time in the future to talk about operating costs, as in it has the opportunity to help reduce the burden of that operating cost because it's part of the statewide network. So that's just wanted to mention that we're for the plan. We really appreciate the partnership. You've been here from the very beginning with this group and others, and we still have our rail staff on the line too if there are any specific questions. Thank you.
Thank you. Is there any fellow commissioner that hasn't spoken for 2 minutes that'd like to speak? Seeing none, I'm going to go ahead and bring this back. I had I had recognized Eduardo Montesino.
And I would just like to move the staff recommendation.
Is there a second?
I'll second Commissioner Caput.
We have a second on that.
I would like to include amendments to the Patrick Mulhern's, and also I forget who. Somebody else made a comment too.
So you want to add Patrick's amendments to the motion? Is that what I understand? Do you accept that?
Please say what that was again. What that proposed.
What was the amendment, Patrick?
So in the resolution.
You're muted now, Patrick. You weren't, but you are again.
You're muted.
Yeah, I'm sorry. I'm trying to switch between documents here. So in the resolution, we've already.
No, you muted
it again.
Anyway, we've already changed the language in the resolution to acknowledge that we would be obligated to enter an environmental study. So what I'm asking is that following the environmental phase prior to implementing the preferred alternative, a tax measure supporting rail transit shall be passed. That's all. Just because it's acknowledging that the report says that there's already a funding gap before we commit to whatever the product of the environmental studies is, we have identified some way to pay for it before we continue to invest in it. That's all.
Do you accept that amendment, Commissioner?
No, I don't.
That amendment? Second.
Is not.
I believe an amendment, point of order, I believe an amendment is seconded or not, and it does not necessarily need to be accepted as a friendly amendment by the maker of the motion.
Correct, obviously.
Yeah. Well, what I understand it was Commissioner Caput was adding that to his second. on requesting that.
But the maker of the motion doesn't see it as friendly. So it would have to be voted on as a separate amendment. Right. And Mann is correct. It would vote on the amendment before you vote on the main motion.
Okay. Sorry about that. So learning process for me also. So
no, that's fine.
All right. So I guess we have a motion to amend and a second.
I just want to clarify something. Patrick, are you saying we have to have a countywide what, vote on some kind of tax before we go forward?
Yeah.
Before we build a rail transit project, yes, we've identified a tax measure to address the funding shortfall that we're already projecting for this project.
I don't go along with that.
Yeah. Okay, Kay, we have roll call, please.
No, wait a minute.
Isn't that the
you're not clear on the motion, Mr. Chair, right now. I think that the commission needs to be clear because I've heard a motion and then there was an attempt to second with an amendment that was not accepted. And so you
need- Yeah, and from what I understood procedurally, that Patrick was making the, requesting the amendment to the motion and that Commissioner Manu could second that. And I need to go through that process first before I can come back
If you have an amended motion on the floor and you have a second on the amended motion, and then you can act on that.
Yeah. It's not amended. There's just an motion to make an amendment, which needs to be discussed and then just voted on first before you come back to the main motion.
Yes, exactly.
And I think Andy wants to talk on the amendment.
So we're going
to
go ahead and discuss on the proposed amendment to the motion. Andy, go ahead.
Yes, I don't really support the amendment because I feel it's premature. Mm-hmm. To decide that what the financing is going to be before we have any information about potential financing. Alternate Johnson talked about the lack of information we have about financing. The PCAA has gross costs. It really doesn't talk about how those costs could be met. I feel there's so much uncertainty about the future. And what funding will be available, what might be feasible, what might not be feasible, to assume that there's going to be the need for a tax measure without the financial information just seems very premature to me. So I think we should put off, I'm just not willing to support that amendment because I don't think that it's really ripe at this time to make that commitment.
Thank you, and Commissioner Andy. Commissioner Beltran.
So basically, we've made a lot of assumptions that this proposal to build whatever it is that we agree with on the transit corridor is going to be funded by grants. Somehow the feds or the state is going to come in and make up for what we cannot pay for ourselves. So to me, it's very reasonable, and it's not an assumption on Patrick's part, that we're going to need some sort of community support for this particular, whatever the proposal actually is. And so actually to put that into the motion, and I agree with Greg, he's trying to understand how we're going to pay for this. So he's thinking about what Patrick said as an amendment, and it's very reasonable to have something in there so the public knows that when we put this forward before them, we actually need to know how much you are going to make this possible. So in politics, when we're trying to figure out how we move forward, it's the possible. And in something like this, a major infrastructure project, it has to be possible. There has to be money to pay for it. So I think it's disingenuous to the public. They're looking to us to figure out a possible proposal, which has to include how much money we are going to make available to make it possible. Thank you.
Thank you, Commissioner. Commissioner Rodkins.
This will allow some of us to make briefer comments on the main motion because we're getting at one of the points here. I agree with Andy's point. It's not that at some point you can't build a railroad without some kind of decision about how you're going to pay for it. And you don't spend a lot of money on either environmental studies or engineering studies to 30% or any others until you have some idea of where you're going and where the money might come from. I don't disagree with that. The question is the timing. And I don't think this is the time for us to stick this in the middle of this. The public has to understand we were not going to spend millions of dollars or billions of dollars on a train proposal without knowing where the money's coming from. That'll have to happen somewhere further down the road. But I don't want to tie down the idea that we're choosing rail as our long-term study option. This is the one, this is our best proposal with this particular constraint. I think it would be a mistake at this time, not a mistake at some point later, for sure.
Commissioner recognizes, Chair recognizes Patrick. Thank
you, Chair. Just very, very briefly, this is from the TCAA that I'm identifying this deficiency. An additional state, federal, and or local source of funds will be needed to fund a shortfall from what is reasonably expected from existing fund sources. The report says there's a funding shortfall. All I'm asking is that after we've identified a project, which would come after an EIR, before we begin building that project, we identify a funding source to address what we'll then know will be what the funding shortfall is. That's all.
Can you call the question?
A point of information.
Go ahead, Commissioner.
Does the vote today, if we pass the resolution with any amendment or not, does it require us to continue to spend money on a next level of environmental review for a preferred alternative?
It's a technical question to staff.
Yeah.
No, it does not.
Thank you.
Thank you. Okay.
Yeah.
Is there any, go ahead, Mr. Cap.
Well, Commissioner Caput. Maybe down the line, I would agree with what Patrick Mulhern said, but I do agree with right now, Commissioner Schifrin and Rotkin, it's premature. So I want to vote that we go forward, and then later on we can always talk about putting it out to the public for a vote.
Thank you, Commissioner Cabot. Commissioner Alternate Schifner.
I wonder if Commissioner Mulhern would be willing to add the instead of the language he originally proposed, the language from the TCAA. Because I think that's more general language, and it's in the report. And it is true, there's going to need to be federal, state, and or local funding if the rail as a preferred alternative is going to happen. And I think just putting that in the resolution is a reasonable approach.
Okay, thank you. Commissioner, can I, let's have the question, roll call on the.
Commissioner, I just want to make sure, because somebody made a mistake last time, repeat the motion, or we're talking about a substitute.
No, it's not a substitute, it's an amendment to the main.
Excuse me, thank you, Mike, you're right, an amendment. I just want to understand the amendment so that I'm clear on the vote.
Is that me? Okay. Yeah. Following the environmental phase, prior to implementing the preferred alternative, a tax measure supporting rail transit shall be passed.
I agree with that.
Broken up. I couldn't hear the motion.
Following the environmental phase, prior to implementing the preferred alternative, a tax measure supporting rail transit shall be passed.
Yeah, I was asked in roll call, Yesenia, so I support that motion. I support that amendment.
Okay, Commissioner Brown?
No.
Commissioner Randy Johnson?
Aye.
Commissioner Montesino?
No.
Commissioner Caput?
No.
Commissioner Alternate Schifrin?
No.
Commissioner Alternate Mulhern?
Aye.
Commissioner Koenig?
Aye.
Commission alternate Myers?
No.
Commission alternate Jenny Johnson?
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez?
No.
And Commissioner Rodkin?
No.
Okay, amendment failed. And so we're now back to the original motion that's on the table. And I'm going to go ahead and open it up to comments.
Commissioner Bertrand has his hand up.
Chair recognizes Commissioner Bertrand.
I'd like to make a substitute motion, if I may, Chair.
A substitute motion. To the motion that's on the table right now?
That's correct. So my substitute motion is that before we move the vote on the alternative proposal by staff, that we wait until the general the general plan is presented to us. The business plan is presented to us at a time when staff determines that they can make it. April 1st is also suggested, but my proposal basically is that we suspend the vote on the preferred analysis right now, that we wait until the business plan is made before us, so we have the information before the public. Thank you.
Commissioner Beltran, I think I also need to be clarified on something. My understanding is that once we vote on the preferred plan, we're also moving with the forward with a business plan. So if we don't approve the preferred plan, there cannot be a business plan established first on the preferred plan. Is that correct, staff?
Yeah. Mr. Chair, I understand your point. I think it's a good point, but we're being asked to make a choice on what the preferred alternative is. And in terms of the relative cost between the four alternatives, we don't have that in terms of the business plan. Now, Ginger did say that all this information is available, and I've talked to other people on staff, and I know it's available, but I would like it to be presented to the public so that they have a chance to see that information. And also, to the point, I want it made perfectly clear what we're voting on in terms of cost. So to me, I think we have the cart before the horse. The horse should be
okay. Clear. You have a motion?
Yes, yeah. I made a motion.
Second? Is there a second on that?
Second.
We have a second discussion on the.
Well, I think I've made my points. I think the rest of the commission should talk.
My hand's up.
Commissioner Rodkin.
How do you have a business plan if you don't know what the business is? You've got to decide first that you have a preferred alternative. Then otherwise you'd be doing a business plan, I suppose on BRT. On commuter rail, which I, you know, other kinds of options that we're probably not moving towards. And to me, or a trail only for that matter, which I'm sure some of our members would think was a great idea, a business plan on the trail. The business plan is on something, and that's the preferred alternative. So first you make that motion. Again, the people that are concerned that we're somehow gonna, once we make this decision about preferred alternative, that we've decided to build it, to spend the money, to move ahead and already tax people on something we don't even know what it is or what the gap is that needs to be funded. Let me be blunt, it's ridiculous. First decide that you have a preferred alternative and then go through a difficult process involving the public on whether you can in fact build that preferred alternative. You might decide it's not feasible, that's possible. I don't think it's the case, but others obviously do. But you gotta first decide what is it you're trying to study a business plan on? So I think the substitute motion is, I'll be blunt, I don't mean it's a personal attack or something, but it makes no sense in terms of a rational decision-making process.
Thank you, Commissioner Rutkins. Is there any other fellow commissioner that wants to make a comment on that?
I have a procedural question. I believe we have to vote on the substitute to accept the substitute motion, but I just want a clarification from council.
Yeah, we're going to do that. I just wanted to take their comments on this motion from the table, and then we're going to ask the question. So I'm just asking, is there any other
point of information? Commissioner Rodkin suggested that somehow the business plan that we're going to see in April is a business plan on the preferred alternative. I just want clarification. My understanding is that the business plan we'll see in April is on passenger rail and light rail, regardless of the decision today, because that's what's owed to the CTC. Is that correct? or is the language somehow tied to the preferred alternative?
I'm happy to speak to that, Chair, if you prefer.
Yes, Ginger.
So the staff is looking for direction from the commission to determine the locally preferred alternative in order to do a business plan on the locally preferred alternative.
Thank you, Ginger, for that clarification. So I'm going to go ahead and ask the question. Can we have roll call, please?
Then can I move?
This is on the substitute motion.
The substitute motion, yes.
Thank you.
Can I move an amendment to Jacques' motion just for clarification that the business plan presented would be on passenger rail and light rail?
I'll accept that amendment.
There's not been a second on his on that.
Second.
The second that.
Well, we got a first.
Virginia Johnson, I seconded.
We have an original motion.
We have an original motion first.
And it was amended by the original motion maker, amended by the second and agreed to by the original motion maker. So you have a motion on the floor that.
Right now, what we have is the original motion. It still has the question still be asked. We had an amendment that failed. And then we have a secondary motion.
Substitute
motion, sorry. Okay. So it's been seconded.
We're voting on the amendment.
No, it's secondary.
Substitute motion is what you're voting on.
Yes.
Yes.
The secondary motion, Greg.
Okay.
Could the chair or secretary repeat the motion as is understood today for the clarification of all commissioners?
Steve, can you do that, please?
So as I understand the substitute motion right now from Bertrand, seconded by Koenig, it would be that the business plan would be prepared before action is taken on the TCAA to approve the preferred alternative. The discussion of the board so far has appeared to be around the business plan being on the rail that is identified as the preferred alternative. But the board should be clear about that because staff needs to respond to your direction as to what you're asking us to come back. And earlier today, you had discussion about a different business plan. And so the staff should get clear direction from the board as to what you want. But as we understand it right now, and Guy, I would ask you to weigh in too, if this is your understanding as well too, that you're asking for the preparation of a business plan that is related to the preferred alternative before you take action on the TCAA to approve it. Guy, is that your understanding of what the motion
is? That's my understanding, that we move forward with a business plan on the staff's recommended preferred alternative before asking the commission to vote on the staff recommended approved alternative.
That's one who made a substitute motion, a correction or whatever you want to call it, to augment what I said. You know, my basic point is that I cannot choose a preferred alternative to the four proposals. We need to have a cost estimate, even if it's rough. And I've also understood from staff that all this information is available. And I want to present it to this board so we could actually look at it firsthand in that concrete form of a business plan.
So right now we have Commissioner Mullen that made an amendment to your secondary motion.
And Steve did not relate that.
And it was seconded by alternate Commissioner Johnson.
Right.
And so
yeah, I have a comment on that if I can.
Yes, Commissioner Rutkins.
So what was now before us in the substitute motion would be to ask that they do a business plan based on rail, but not take advantage of all the data that we've gathered over the last year through the TCAA process, which is exactly how you build a business plan. It's based on data, information, so forth. But the commission's going to, if we pass the substitute motion, will not opine on the issue of whether they should use the actual study that they did and the information they gathered and they concluded to move ahead. isn't this really basically saying, well, yeah, it's based on the whole thing, but we don't want to vote that you should base it on that stuff. That's what we want you to do. It lacks courage on some level. If you're not saying you approve of the rail that you're going to vote for, or you want to spend the money on it or something, all you're saying is among the options that we want studied further is the rail. And that's the main motion that's now, and so voting for the substitute basically directs staff to do something without giving them clear guidelines for what the data should be in a business plan.
Commissioner Alternate Schiffer.
Yes, thank you very, thank you. We've heard from literally hundreds of people about whether the commission should approve rail as the staff recommendation accepts the study that approves rail as the preferred alternative, or to not do it. We've heard a lot on both sides. I think, you know, this, as far as I'm concerned, the substitute motion is really a way to deny approval of rail as a preferred alternative. I think that to quibble over whether the business plan should be done first or the business plan should be done after is really, you know, we're never going to get the information we need to know for sure whether rail is going to be feasible in the foreseeable future. We can get more information, but the question before the commission today is, do we agree that rail should be the preferred alternative? If we do, we should vote no on this motion, I think. If we don't, then we should vote yes, because it's really tantamount to saying that we don't want to accept rail as the preferred alternative.
Thank you, Commissioners. Schiffer, is there any other fellow commissioners that would like to comment on the amendment to the secondary motion?
No, it's to the substitute motion.
Substitute motion. The amendment to the substitute motion.
You have both Johnsons with their hands raised.
Commissioner Johnson. Randy.
Thank you, Chair. So to my Commissioner Rutter, many alternatives are rejected out of hand prior to presented, say, to a board or moving forward, because it just doesn't make sense financially. Okay, and as a board, I made the point at earlier times, we can't always think like a business, because if we did, we wouldn't have affordable housing, we probably wouldn't have transit or whatever. But there are times when you have to insert the whole concept of feasibility before you start jumping off and pursuing things that just won't work. I think one of your favorite terms is a fool's errand. I love it. But to me, in many ways, it's a fool's errand to kind of spend lots and lots of time. And you keep saying we won't spend any money, but we've spent, you know, boatloads of money already pursuing this alternative. And then another studies to think about this and do this that are all conflicting. It's very confusing. It's not out of the realm, and it's not illogical to kind of, you know, make a decision based on, can we actually afford this? Okay, so I'm saying, you know, it's a chicken and the egg question, but it's not crazy for somebody like Jacques to say, we want to know if this is feasible before we move forward and spend massive amounts of consultant times and expense and staff time and expense pursuing something that ultimately will just not make sense. Thank you, Chair.
Thank you, Commissioner Johnson, for those comments. Commissioner Alternate Johnson.
Thank you, Chair. I disagree with Commissioner Rotkin that this suggestion and this motion by Mr. Boutron would not take advantage of the data in the TCA. In fact, Commissioner Koenig's amendment to the commission with a second, or to the amendment, sorry, his amendment to the, y'all
substitute,
know what I'm talking about.
Substitute motion.
Thank you. It basically says, and I think that the council and the executive director articulated it very well, that we direct the staff to do a business plan on the proposed preferred alternative before we actually say yes to the whole thing. And that is not meant to say that we shouldn't leave our options open for rail in the future or for now if we can afford it. Commissioner McPherson completely supports making sure that we have that option. It's bad public policy to do otherwise. So it's simply saying, let's have the business plan on the proposed preferred alternative before we say yes to the whole thing. And that's a completely reasonable thing to say yes, to vote for.
Thank you. Thank you, Commissioner. I want to go ahead and just bring it back and to the question for the substitute motion amendment, right? Yeah, I got to do this.
It's not an amendment, it's a substitute motion. If it passes, the other motion goes away.
Commissioner Conu made an amendment to the substitute motion.
We don't have to vote on that because both and his second agreed to put that in their motion. That's what we're voting on now.
All right.
Is that correct, Steve?
Is that correct?
That is correct. As we have articulated, and at the risk of doing this, I think it's critically important that the record be clear as to what everybody is voting on here. So again, we understand, the staff understands the motion to be that the commission would direct us to prepare the business plan on the proposed preferred alternative, and that would be reported back to the commission before the commission takes action on the TCAA, which would mean you would not obviously take action on the TCAA today. That's what we understand the motion to be.
Thank you.
Okay, can we have the question?
Okay, Commissioner Bertrand.
I agree.
Commissioner Brown.
No.
Commissioner Randy Johnson.
Agree.
Commissioner Montesino.
No.
Commissioner Caput.
No.
Commission Alternate Schifrin.
No.
Commission Alternate Mulhern.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Johnson.
Yes.
Commissioner Koenig.
Aye.
Commission Alternate Myers.
Aye. No.
Commissioner Gonzalez.
No.
And Commissioner Rodkin.
No.
What is the final tally?
Seven no's.
Seven no's. 7-5.
Five yes.
So the motion fails.
Motion failed, right?
That's correct. Now go back. Now you're back on the main motion as amended.
Okay. And I just want to make sure that the attorney understood that it did fail, right?
Yeah, yes. The motion failed on a 5-7 vote. There were 5 A's and 7 no's.
Okay, thank you. Okay, we're going to come back to the original motion on the table.
Can you read it?
Can we reread it, that motion, so we can have the question?
It was just to approve the staff recommendation, is that correct?
Yes.
That is correct. I think with all the discussion that the commission had about substitute motions, I was not clear whether there was a clear second with no amendments, just proceeding with the staff recommendation. Is there a second?
There was a second by Commissioner Caput.
Okay, thank you.
Chair, I want to make a point of order and ask Steve Mattis, can a question be, can you bring the question forward and, ask the question unilaterally, or doesn't that have to go before a vote, needs a second, has to be voted upon, needs 2/3 votes before you end discussion?
No, absolutely not.
Well, rules of Robert rules of order that way.
The chair rules, and then you can vote to overturn the chair, but the chair will, in this case, decide whether we can simply proceed to a vote on this motion. We don't have to have a vote about whether to vote or not. If Aurelio wants to move ahead with the vote right now, he can move to do that. Anybody that thinks that he's being premature or something could vote to overturn him without discussion. Have a vote on whether to overturn his decision. That's how it should be done under Robert's Rules of Order.
Well, that's what I'm saying, is that typically you call the question. Wait a sec, Mike.
typically. Randy, have you ever in your city council meetings in Scotts Valley ever voted on whether you have a right to vote? We don't do it that way. You can do that, but the chair has ruled we're going to skip that step. If you think we need to vote on whether we're going to be able to vote, you can make a motion to overturn him once he makes his ruling.
Well, that's
I teach parliamentary law.
I am bringing the question.
Well, I think a question was asked of the commission attorney, and the commission attorney should respond. I'm not clear what the question is, but if it, you know, I've never heard of a situation where we had to vote before we voted on the main motion on the floor. But I think that if I understood Commissioner Johnson, that was the question he asked our attorney, and the attorney should respond to it. Not to negate anything that Commissioner Rodkin said, but he's not the attorney for the commission.
No, if you have a motion and a second on the floor and the motion gets called, the question gets called, then the board should act on that. If they wish to override the determination of the chair, if there's a desire on the part of any of the commissioners to override the determination of the chair to call the question, then that should be a separate motion that should take place and the board should vote on that. But calling the question after you've had discussion is a motion that takes precedence over other motions. And so I think if the commission is now back on the first motion, which was a motion to approve the staff recommendation that was seconded with no modifications, then the commission's at a point where you either call the question or have discussion on that motion.
You call the question.
And I called the question.
Of course you did.
Okay. Commissioner Bertrand.
No.
Commissioner Brown.
Aye.
Commissioner Randy Johnson.
No.
Commissioner Montesino.
Yes.
Commissioner Caput.
Aye.
Commissioner Alternate Schifrin.
Aye.
Commissioner Alternate Mulhern.
Yes.
Commissioner Koenig.
No.
Commissioner Alternate Jenny Johnson.
Yes.
Commissioner Alternate Myers.
Aye.
Commissioner Gonzalez.
Aye.
And Commissioner Rodkin.
Aye.
Well, thank you, commissioners. Thank you for that lively conversation and experience.
Now an expert on Robert's Rules of Order.
I have delved into further.
Thank you, Chair, for surviving it.
Really?
Chair,
you did a great job.
Patrick has a comment. He's got his hand in the air.
I do. It's a point of order, actually. We don't use Robert's Rules of Order. We use Rosenberg's rules.
Oh, that's true.
It's very short. I recommend everybody take a look at it. It's like 10 pages long. It's not like a million pages like Robert's Rules. Very easy to understand.
Mr. Chair, may I make a comment, please?
Yes, Commissioner Alternate Johnson.
Thank you. I appreciate that. I voted for the staff recommendation because we do need a business plan, and it's important. But that is a vote. That's not necessarily a vote to move forward with building this project unless we know what the money situation is going to look like. So I just want to make sure that the money and the financial picture is a very important piece, and I support knowing that fully. Thank you.
Thank you, Alternate Commissioner Johnson. I can concur with you on that. It's important that we move forward.
Many of us do.
Yeah, we're gonna go ahead and we're gonna move forward on this. We're gonna go to item 20, review of items to be discussed in closed session.
Mr. Chair,
a quick question for Mr. Mattis. You said we're not Robert's Rules of Order, but we're what, Rosenberg?
Rosenberg Rules of Order, and right. We can work with staff to send you the copy that Commissioner Mulhern identified. It is a short document, much easier to follow than Robert's Rules typically.
Thank you. We're not Congress. Thank heavens.
Yeah, we don't have a filibuster rule.
Yeah, really.
Okay.
Yeah, sorry, Mr. Chair, that sometimes, you know, I may have talked over you. I totally support you in your position to keep order here. And you know,
that's better. Right. I'm trying to give everybody the best opportunity to talk about the subject. I know it's an important topic for our community.
Mr. Chair, I'm sorry. We started that with the you had asked me about the closed session report, and I'm not sure.
Yeah, review. We're on item number 20 now. Review of items to be discussed in closed session.
Right. So, Mr. Chair, we do have one item related to real property negotiations in closed session. We're not anticipating a reportable action out of closed session. So we can, when the commission is ready, we can convene to closed session. And the commissioners would have received an email this morning from Ian Berry of CTV with the Zoom link for the closed session.
Okay, thank you. I'm going to open it up to the public. Do they have any comments on any on the items on the closed session?
I do not see any raised hands.
Okay, with that, I'd like to not adjourn the meeting, but we're going to move on to closed session. And I'd like to thank the public for participating and being involved in these efforts. Thank you.
We log on to another.
Should have an email.
Okay. So we have to log on to another site,
yes.
Right?
Yes, you should receive it through your email.
Okay, thank you.
Can the staff resend that? Because I'm looking at my email and I don't see an invitation to.